This conference will now be recorded.
We'll start with the session. So, good morning, everyone. We'll start with the front end training demo session. So, this would be the agenda. We'll start with the schedule, how that today's session will be planned, institute overview about myself and trainer profiles. Courses offered and how do you choose the right course, the course overview, the institute facilities, placements, and technical aspects. Backend is next. No. See, the backend training is starting on coming Saturday. Anyway, you can attend this. Okay. Basically, today's demo session is for RTL. It is for the people who are attending, who want to enroll for RTL design and functional verification course, who want to enroll for Verilog for design and verification, system Verilog for functional verification, FPGA design and functional verification, RTL design and integration, and DFT training. So all the people who are looking for any of these courses, today is the demo session. What we do is we categorize the courses into two categories. One is front end domain courses, one is back end domain courses. In both the courses, there are few aspects that are common to every domain. Let's say whether you get into FPGA, whether you get into RTL, or whether you get into RTL design and verification, you need to undergo some common courses like digital electronics, advanced digital electronics. You should be good with Verilog. You should be having basic idea of classic flow. For them, we plan a common 2 months course. Again, for the people who are attending backend courses, that means physical design, custom layout, synthesis STA, there are a few courses. For them, there are courses like device fundamentals. Then backend basics, VLSI backend basics, which are again planned for 2 months. Because of that, we try to merge multiple courses to start at same time so that we can utilize our resources properly. What is mean by resources is, as a trainer, my time will be limited. It is a temporary thing. After 1 or 2 minutes, that disturbance will be gone. Otherwise, my audio quality is good. Can you hear me properly? So, these six courses will be the demo session. The front end demo session will go from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. It is for the people who are interested in any of these courses. This is for 9 a.m. to whatever, starting now till 12:30 p.m. We'll of course have the breaks. The people who are interested in DFT demo session, for them the basic VLSI introduction session will go from 9 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. And in the afternoon, I will let you know the timing. This was previous batch when we scheduled at 3:30 p.m. We'll check with the trainer and we'll let you know what time the DFT demo session will happen. So we'll be starting off with the basic VLSI introduction session. So the institute overview, we were set up in 2012. We would have trained close to 3,700 plus candidates since 2012. 2,000 plus candidates trained in system Verilog and UVM based verification. And we would have close to 1,100 plus placements overall. So the course highlights are courses are offered in complete spectrum of VLS and embedded systems. I mean, what we mean by complete spectrum is we just don't offer training in Verilog, System Verilog, UVM, or just physical design. Majorly, if you see across all the places, it will be Verilog, System Verilog, UVM, and physical design. We have another 25-30 courses which are not there in many of the other places, other institutions. What I mean by that is we have a complete full-fledged course on RTL integration, synthesis STA, then courses on protocols like PCI Express, DDR, USB, and the courses on PCI Express VIP development. There are multiple courses which are targeted even for working professionals. Most of the places the training is targeted for freshers. We have courses which are targeted for freshers as well as for experienced engineers. The course are student-centric. When we say student-centric, I mean we try to keep it affordable. We try to keep the curriculum which is more focused towards the industry requirements, and curriculum updated for the industry requirements. We keep changing the curriculum, like as you know, VLSI industry, or for that matter any industry, keeps changing. It's just that VLSI changes very quickly. Every 1 year, every 2 years, a new technologies come. We go to new technology nodes in fabrication. There are a lot of changes happens in VLSI. So it is important for training institutes to keep up with the changing requirements of the industry, so that we can cater to the employer requirements. Let's say we teach what is relevant 10 years back, and the companies won't be able to hire you and won't be able to get put you into a project with that kind of skill set. And we offer a among the longest courses, front end functional education, 6.5 months exhaustive training. We intentionally keep it so long. Initially, we would have started with probably 4-5 years back. We would have had 5 months of course. Later, we increased it to 5.5 months. Later, we did to 6 months. Later, finally, we did it to 6.5 months. What we realized is we had to spend more time. If we take Verilog, we are spending 8 weeks of full-fledged time, so that we can go in depth of Verilog. We want to make sure that each topic is covered in depth. System Verilog is covered for 3 months, full 3 months. UVM is covered only for 1.5 months, because from a fresher perspective, UVM is not very important. I mean, you don't need to learn very in depth of UVM. So we are giving more focus on digital electronics, Verilog, System Verilog, and the standard protocols and the projects based on those protocols. So that is how this course is 6.5 months course. And I believe that more time we spend teaching and giving you the required skill set, your quality of learning will be better. And that is what effectively translates into you getting a job. Because everyone undergoes a training some or other place, but what is that makes the difference? That small difference in your preparation levels is what makes the difference in getting a job. So just about myself, I am the founder of the institute. I have dual degree from IIT Madras. So I have 8+ years of professional teaching experience. I mean, I have been teaching since 2012. I have started my career in 2005. I have left my job in 2019. So for 7 years, I was doing both teaching and job. Then in 2019, I have quit my job. Now I'm full-time into training. That is what enables me to do almost 80% of the course I personally do. Verilog, System Verilog, UVM. I personally do. Earlier, I used to share with some other trainers, but mostly it has come down now. I handle, because I understand the requirements better. I mean, the institute specific requirements are what I want to get from a specific batch. So I plan all my batches. And that's, as I said, I have 14 years of working experience. And I am also a lead trainer for Mentor Higher Education Program. I mean, Mentor Graphics has one higher education program, which they offer for 1.5 months for selected students. So I am the main trainer for that course. About other trainers' profile, other than me, I mean, I can't be handling all the courses, right? Because there are courses in VLSI backend domain, physical design, custom layout, synthesis and STA, DFT, embedded system. There are many other domains. To offer those courses, we work with the 25 consultant trainers. What I mean by consultant trainers is these all people are working in the industry during their off time, that is Saturday and Sunday, sometimes during weekdays, they conduct the sessions. These trainers are having expertise in VLSI, FPGA, embedded systems, and across these domains. All of them are currently working in the industry. They come with a passion for teaching, and their average experience would be around 10 years. Generally, mostly the courses are driven by my interest. I mean, I overlook the courses, and we have other supporting members. The manager, his name is Vaibhav, and there are other supporting staff who look after different responsibilities in terms of the placement. I mean, we divide the whole flow during the course, what kind of support need to be provided to student after the course. I mean, let's say you have completed with the training, how can we continue to support you? Because let's say you have completed training in September 2020, now it is March 2021, there is a good chance that you lose, and unless you keep practicing the things, you lose touch with the subject. So that is where you continue to get the support from institute. What we have recently started is we are organizing weekend sessions where we are revising the topics. Then whoever has completed the training, we create a dedicated job support group for them. I'll just show you what I mean. I mean, I know it probably may not be in exactly in context. So we create, let's say, if I take DFT job support group. So this is the job support group where everyone is added in that group. Let's say around 90 participants are there. Many of them are admins. It would be close to 80 people. We keep conducting sessions even though they have completed training. We regularly, or weekends, we keep conducting some kind of revision sessions. And this group is used for posting the job support and other things. Similarly, for other domains also, we have the groups where we post the job requirements, and we keep conducting the sessions regularly. This is something which we have started recently, so as to make sure that, like, this was one of the sessions that was done on last Sunday. It is just to tell you that the course connection between the institute and the students is not just for the 6 months that you undergo training. We try to make sure that we continue to support you, or continue to get connected with you, to support you with the project, with the technical aspects and everything. And the same group will be used for providing with the job support, all the aspects. And in the same group, we keep posting the evaluation tests, and we correct and we inform you where you need to improve. All those aspects is done through this kind of group. So similar groups are maintained for every domain. Let's say if I take TV job. So this is where we post the job requirements. Like, we had Ultron job requirement recently. So whatever job requirements comes, we keep posting. We conduct evaluation tests to this group. And the same group is used for conducting those technical sessions and all those aspects. So I was talking about the trainer profiles. Okay. Now, courses offered. We are primarily a VLSI training institute with another branch, another domain of training, that is embedded systems. Since most of you are here for VLSI training, so I will be talking about VLSI flow overview. The intention of next few slides is just to give you a quick overview of VLSI flow. Sometimes what happens, students take up a course based on someone's recommendation. Like, one of your senior is working in VLSI. He's earning a good salary, very good salary. And second reason could be he has done his bachelor's in electronics or electrical, and he's already into VLSI. So that is what motivates other people also to get into VLSI. In some cases, not every case. So he might be working in front-end domain, functional verification. He will tell you that you go and take functional verification. He might be working in custom layout. He will tell you what? Go and join custom layout, right? Because the person who is working in custom layout, for him, custom layout is the good domain. Custom layout is the domain where there are many opportunities and other things. He may not have the perspective of other domains. Same thing with physical design. Someone working in physical design may recommend you to join physical design. My point is that his perspective is different, your perspective is different, right? I mean, he may have expertise in physical design skill set. He may have expertise in functional verification skill set. But what is that? The same skill set is interesting for you. I want you to spend a few minutes, just understand what is what. I don't want, because given a short time of 3 hours, we cannot really go in depth of what is VLSI design. But I still want you to understand majorly what is the skill set required for front end domain, what is the skill set required for back end domain. Based on that, you can choose whether to go for front end domain or back end domain. So now we will be talking about VLSI design flow. We majorly divide the VLSI design flow into two aspects: pre-synthesis flow and post-synthesis flow. Can someone tell me what is VLSI design flow is all about?
Sir, it's all about getting to the knowing about front end and back end. I mean, how the whole system chip. It's about the chip design process, that in the front end what happens in verification, and in the back end physical design is there. So it's up to the whole process how the chip is going to be generated from the foundries.
Yes. So basically, VLSI design flow is all about making a chip that works. Simple, in very simple terms, it is about making a chip that works. It applies to everywhere. I mean, to understand what is VLSI design flow, you can take a correlate with any other example. House construction is the easiest example. That is something we see day to day happening, right? So how does it start? It starts with your requirements, where you require, you figure out that what is that you want from a house. How many floors, how many rooms, what is your requirement, everything. Then what do? You understand that. I don't want to go step by step. You go to architect. He gives you architecture diagram. It's not just one paper. He gives you a proper document where he tells how many beams, how many plinths, everything. He will give you detailed instructions about all the aspects of the diagram. The diagram is not the house, right? Let's say this is the diagram. One diagram is there. That doesn't become house. Starting from the diagram, that architecture diagram, till the time you take it to a completion where you can enter into the house and you can start living in the house. That is what we are calling as a house construction. The same concept applies to VLSI design. After architect, where will you go? You will go to a contractor, you will go to a masonry. Then you will have some laborers who go through different stages: construction, then painting, plumbing, carpentry, different stages. How many stages we can divide house construction into? Roughly, how many stages?
5 to 6
stages. How many stages as per you? Someone else may say 8 stages. Someone else may say 10 stages. So it depends upon the person, how you look at the things. See, I will say architect is one stage. Even before architect, listing down requirements is one step for me. Because that is very important, right? If you list down the requirements wrongly, then even after constructing the house, it won't fulfill your requirement. Architect is second stage. Approaching a masonry is third stage. Like that, if I look at it, I may get 10 stages. He may get 7 stages. He may get only 6 stages. But does the house construction change? No, right? It's the same flow. Same way, VLSI design flow, based on who tell you, in some cases it can have 10 stages. I mean, some people may say 10 stages are there. In some cases, people may say 15 stages are there. But eventually what they are doing is they are merging two stages into one, or they are dividing one stage into two or three stages. That is what is effectively happening. So now going to the VLSI design flow, the way house construction has started with the requirements. The chip construction, let's call chip construction, instead of calling it as chip fabrication, let us use a simple term like chip construction. It starts with requirements of the chip. What do you want from the chip? Then it goes to the architect. Like we have a house architect, we have a chip architect who gives you the architecture diagram. From him, he gives out, like, the what does house architect gives me? He gives me the architecture diagram along with that the very detailed fine details about each aspect of the construction. Same way, the design architect gives me a design architecture diagram. What all blocks are required? how they are connected to each other, what frequency they should be working at, and what is the functionality of the each block. He gives me a clear diagram like that. So I will probably show you the architecture diagram as well. He gives me a proper architecture diagram. You can just go on Google and just say SOC architecture diagram. You'll just get it. Any sample architecture diagram. Go to images. This is one architecture diagram. This kind of diagram he'll give you, where he will tell you that CPU subsystem. Like when you purchase a mobile phone, you see the core, right? What core is it? Qualcomm, which Snapdragon, which version of the Snapdragon? That is what we are talking about here. And application subsystem, modules, modem subsystem, different blocks will be there. He will give you this kind of diagram. Along with that, he will give you a detailed document about each and every subsystem, how these are connected to each other. What is the clock? What is the time? What is the frequency of the clock? What are the ports? Everything he will give very detailed information. Because as we said, if something is done wrong anywhere, there is any mistake is done anywhere, the chip won't function properly. Chip will not function properly. So from this architecture and specification, there are two things architect will give you. What are the two things? Design architecture and the specification. There will be a person called design engineer, RTL engineer or design engineer you call. He uses Verilog or VHDL. He will develop register transfer level code. He develops register transfer level code using which language? Verilog, right? Either Verilog or VHDL. This he does for individual blocks. He does for this block. One more person will do for graphics, 3D graphics. One more person will do for audio, video, DSP, AV. And one more person will do for this one. So what has happened? There is one engineer who has developed this subsystem. One more person who has developed this. One more person who has developed this. One more person who has developed this. Like different blocks are developed by different people. What is that you need to do? One, if someone has developed each of them, you need to merge. Technically, that merging is called as integration. What you are calling merge in a day-to-day life, that is called as putting together everything into one system is called as what? Integration. You are integrating. In a very crude terms, like when you purchase a desktop, you assemble the things, right? You assemble CD-ROM, motherboard, everything. That is called as assembly. The same thing when you do in the flow, it is called as RTL integration, because RTL is developed. You are integrating them. Hence, it becomes RTL integration. Once RTL integration is done, we need to see that whether is it working fine? Is whatever that has been developed, whatever coding has been done, is it working fine or not? Is there any functional issues in that? That stage is called as functional verification. This, all these five steps together, put together, we call as what? VLSI front-end flow, also called as pre-synthesis. Because why it is pre-synthesis? It happens before a stage called as synthesis. See, the whole VLSI design flow is divided by one major step called as synthesis. What is synthesis? Process of converting RTL code, whatever you have written in English, it's not English, in Verilog behavioral code, into gate level netlist is called as synthesis. What is an example of synthesis? I'll just give you. Let's say you have developed D flip flop using Verilog. I'm not sure how many of you are completely new to Verilog module D flip flop. We are developing a Verilog code for D flip flop. Clock reset D Q. Input clock reset D, output reg Q. Always at the rate of positive edge of clock, begin end. If reset is applied, that is reset equal to 1, make Q equal to 0, else Q equal to D. This is Verilog behavioral coding for D flip flop. This is called as what? Verilog, behavioral coding for D flip flop. When we convert, basically you cannot manufacture this code, because to manufacture, what do you need? You need transistors. To manufacture a chip, you need what? Transistors. How do you get transistors? You get it from the gates. Basically, to manufacture chip, we need circuit in terms of transistors. We don't want English code. See, I cannot use this code and use as a mobile phone, right? I cannot take English code and use as a mobile phone. It's not possible. So basically, I need the circuit in terms of transistors. How do you get the transistors from? It came from logic gates. Logic gates means what? AND gate, OR gate, XOR gate, all that. Going forward, when you attend Verilog course,
sir, I have a question. I have a query here. I'll complete this. I have a query here, sir. Okay.
Yeah, tell me. Yeah.
Just a simple query regarding gates and transistors. Sir, basically, we have heard that gates are a basic building block of all the digital circuits, right? I have a confusion regarding that. Like, are the transistors are the basic building blocks of gates, or gates are made up of transistors? This I have confused, because transistors are made up of silicon, and
gates are made up of transistors. So okay. Basically, if you take the CMOS inverter, this is how a inverter is made using like this circuit.
Yeah.
This is VDD. This is ground. This is input. This is output. This is how you make a CMOS inverter. How do you make a CMOS NAND gate? Two PMOS and two NMOS. PMOS in parallel or serial? How do you make a NAND gate?
So NAND in parallel.
Parallel, right? A
PMOS.
B. NMOS in series. Down it is series. This is VDD. This is VDD. This is ground. This is the output. So how does it? I mean, let's not get into this thing. How it behaves like a NAND gate. But Gaurav, does it answer your question? Basically, transistors are the building blocks.
My question is clear.
Okay.
Gates. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Before it is logic gates. Before it logic gates, it is written in. The logic is written in. In an algorithmic manner. Reason is, you know how many, if you take a mobile phone, it will have billion gates. Billion means what? 100 crore gates. Manually placing the gates and telling like this. Example is what? If I take a half adder. What is half adder circuit? Sum is what? Carry is what? Sum is carry is XOR. Sum is XOR gate. A XOR B. Carry is what? A and B. For a half adder, it is simple. If I want to manufacture, let's say you ask me, you come to me and tell me that, please give me a half adder chip. I can easily give you. What I can do? I will take this kind of thing, A, B, XOR gate, sum, A, B, this is AND gate, this is carry, sum and carry. This is possible. Why? There are only two gates. Now AND gate will convert to how many transistors? Six transistors. XOR may convert to 10 transistors. Let's take. Totally, how many transistors are there? 16 transistors are there. Can everyone hear me? So till some limited number of transistors, it is fine. Once it becomes 100 transistors, is it possible? to manually tell which will connect, which drain, which gate will connect here. It's not possible, right? Hence, since it is here, two gates are there, it is possible. As you increase the number of gates, it becomes 10, you will feel some difficulty. It becomes 100, you will feel some difficulty. What happens if it becomes 100 crores? It is impossible, right, for us to manually tell A will go here, B will go here, A will go here, B will go here. You cannot do that. That is where comes a very high level description language called as Verilog behavioral coding. It's called as what? Verilog behavioral coding, where you are going to tell the logic more in an English format. You are going to tell that if at the positive edge of clock, if this happens, output will be this, else output will be this. Like that, you are going to write in an English kind of format. You are not going to write in standard cells, or you are not going to write in transistor format. That will be synthesized into logic gates. This step is called as synthesis. The step is called as what? Synthesis. What is synthesis? Converting this kind of English kind of code. You see, it's English, right? Always positive edge of clock. If reset is applied, do something. This is more close to English. What will happen is, if you give this as input to a synthesis tool, it gives you logic gates. Logic gates means what? The B flip-flop in terms of AND gate, OR gate, NAND gate, whatever is the minimum possible, it will give you. That will be, that logic gates will be taken through the backend flow. That is what we call as VLSI backend. That flow is called as what? VLSI backend flow, which involves synthesis, DFT, physical design, static timing analysis, custom layout, physical verification, fabrication, post-silicon validation. Since most of you are here for front-end domain, I'm not stressing much on the backend aspects. Okay, so how many stages are there totally? Totally, how many stages are there? 12 stages are there, right? 5 plus 7, 12 stages are there. I am telling 12. Some other trainer who will do this teaching and he doesn't have this presentation, someone else who comes for this training may tell you that it is totally 10 stages only. Instead of 12, he may tell you 10 stages. Some other trainer may tell you 15 stages. But the base concept remains same. What is the basic concept? It starts with requirements and you take it till post-silicon validation. It goes through various stages. We can majorly divide the whole flow into what? Two aspects. One we call as what? Front-end flow, which is these aspects. Other is what? Back-end flow, which are all these aspects. Now the next question comes. Why is it important for us to know this much? I mean, I came here only for Verilog training or front end training. Let me attend only front end. Going forward in the next slides, I'll tell you why it is important for us to know this flow. Okay.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Yeah.
Sir, may I know how can this functional verification and testing have come before logic synthesis?
Basically, even after synthesis, there will be some one step called as gate level simulation. If you ask me, even after this flow, right? There will be a step here called as GLS, gate level simulations. Whatever, basically, the whatever functional verification we are calling or testing you are calling, testing happens at every stage of the chip. There will be testing happening here also. Even after RTL design, you do functional verification. Even after RTL integration, you do functional verification. Even after synthesis, you do functional verification. Even after physical design also, you do physical functional verification. Because we cannot afford to have even a one bug in the chip. Let's say mobile phone is there. Mobile phone has many functionalities. Or let's take laptop. Laptop has many functionalities. Assume keyboard is not working. What is going to happen? That's a faulty laptop, right? Assume It has got three USB ports. How many? Three. And one USB port is not working. Will you adjust saying that it's okay? It's not working. No, right? That's the, what is that? It's a faulty chip. Even if small feature doesn't work, you have to, that chip is basically faulty chip. So in summary, at every stage, you need to keep checking whether the chip is working fine or not. So that means the checking will happen here also. Here also. Here also. Even after physical design, it happens. Even after custom layout, they may do. At every stage, they check, is there any impact in the functionality? Is functionality working fine? They will keep checking that. Fanindra, is it clear to you?
Yes, sir. So before the RTL is given to the synthesis guy, so yeah, they'll be doing this functional verification and then will be given.
Yes, yes. Only when, only once the functionality is correct, then only you can synthesize, right? Let's say RTL code is wrong. Instead of putting plus, you have put a minus, for example. If you synthesize, what is going to happen? Instead of adder, it will synthesize to a subtraction logic. Then my chip will be, instead of having a addition logic in the chip, what logic will be there? Subtraction logic. Will it work properly when you take it to the actual chip? No, right?
No, no.
Hence, that need to be verified before you do the synthesis.
Okay.
Some misconceptions regarding the VLSI jobs. I'll just take a few minutes. First misconception is I can get job in different domains of VLSI by learning complete VLSI. Not many people, some 5% of the people come to us saying that I want to do complete VLSI front end flow, back end flow, everything I want to do. So I will have job, like when during my plus two, after 10th, someone said, do both MPC, IPC, you will be able to get into either MBBS or engineer. Is it possible? Technically, is it possible with the amount of load that is required in preparing? Not possible. Right? Either you can focus on engineering domain or you can focus in medical. You cannot get into both. Same is the thing here. Because why it was not possible in after 10th class? Because 2 years is sufficient for preparing to either engineering or medicine. If I was given 5 years, let's say they said your intermediate will go for 10 plus 2 will go for 5 years, 10 plus 5. Then fine, I would have prepared for both. Same is the problem here. You have a limited time of 6 months to 1 year. You have a limited time of 1 year. In 1 year, it is at best you can gain expertise in only one domain. You take 12 domains are there. How many domains are there here? 12 domains. Among these 12 domains, it will take you full 12 months to gain a complete expertise. You cannot even focus on other domain also. Why am I making this observation? Why am I telling that? I have seen close to 3,500 plus students. So I know how students come. You may be smart, but then it has its own challenges to learn. Hence, it's not possible to learn many things. So VLSI design. So what is the answer? VLSI design flow has 12 steps. It takes at least 6 months to gain expertise in any of the above domains. Why am I telling then? Why I was telling 12 months? To gain an expertise where you can just go to the job and start working like an experienced person. It will require that additional time. 6 months will make you good as a fresher, a very good fresher. But industry wants more actually. With the competition, rising competition, the industry companies want more from you. So how do you get that? You need to spend more time. That is where you should not be deviating into other aspects. Hence, it is not possible to gain expertise in the complete flow in short span of 1 year. It's not possible. Does it mean that I should not learn complete VLSI flow? Basically, it's a good idea to get basic idea of what happens in each aspect of the flow. You should know what is meant by RTL integration. You should know what is meant by RTL design. You should know what is meant by functional verification. You should know what is meant by synthesis. What is it? That's all. You don't need to know how is it done. You don't need to know how physical design is done. There are three stages. What is it? How it happens? And more in depth of how it is gets done actually. You can stop at first stage. You don't need to go to remaining two stages also. You should know that physical design means what? You have a gate level code, netlist. What you mean by netlist is AND gate, OR gate, different thing will be there. You need to bring it into a completed floor plan, placement, routed netlist. That's a very technical high level definition. If you understand what happens there, that is sufficient. You don't need to know what is meant by floor plan, What is mean by placement? What is mean by power planning? Because that is a knowledge which you won't require and you won't use anywhere. Choose one domain based on skill set interesting for you. Gain expertise in that domain. Basically, important thing is what? Choosing the right domain is important. 80% of the people does work in a single domain for all of their career. I worked for close to 14 years. Throughout my career, I was only doing one domain, that is functional verification. In my whole career, I didn't do anything other than this one. Then I know people who have done only physical design and STA throughout their career. They are 25 years experienced. They have done only physical design and STA throughout 25 years. They don't even know what is front end also, to be frank. Does it mean that they are not successful in their career? They are successful. I mean, different people have different measures of what is success. In all the measures, they are successful in terms of the salary, in terms of the career growth, in terms of their domain expertise. They have been successful. In what does it mean is, you don't need to learn each aspect of the flow. But what is more important, because you are going to work in this domain for next visible 35 to 40 years, that's assuming you are 23, 24, 22. Assuming you are going to work till 60, at least 35 years you are going to work in this domain. So choosing that one right domain is the important. What is right domain for you? Something that is interesting to your skill set, whatever you like, that's what you should choose. Rather than someone told you do this, do that, right? Because as I told you in the beginning, someone might tell you that do verification based on their interest. Like I like programming, for example. If someone comes and tell me, I will be more inclined to ask them to take for functional verification course. Because I see that for me, functional verification looks easy. Coding, this whole coding, it looks very easy for me. For someone who is new to the coding, he will be wondering what is module, what is input, what is output, what is always. So you need to figure out what is interesting for you. Then you should choose a course. That is where we are discussing about what is front-end domain, what is back-end domain. Okay, now how do I choose which domain is right for me? With all these domains, how do I choose which domain is right for me? Basically, how many steps we divided the whole VLSI flow into? 12 steps. These works are distributed among freshers and experienced. When you join a job as a fresher, companies won't give you every work. They will only give you low priority work. They will give you what? A low priority work. Because you are a fresher, you are still learning. Who will get the high priority work? Experienced people, right? Natural. So going by that priorities, we will divide it into two categories. What is given to fresher? What is given to experienced? For example, design requirements. Only experienced engineer can do that. Let's say you have to list down what is required in a chip. What is required in a mobile phone chip? Anything only experienced people can do. Coming up with the architecture and specification, who can do? Can fresher do that? No, right? It's not possible. Because understanding what block to connect where, what should be the frequency, what kind of synchronizer to use, what kind of power planning to do, what kind of UPF, that power division to be done, everything a fresher cannot do. That is something you gain expertise as you make your career, then you become that capable where you can come up with the architecture. Typically, architects will be of around 15 to 20 years experience, easily, minimum. Then comes RTL design. RTL design is also one important aspect which decides how efficient is the RTL coded. I mean, how the chip will behave. That is also not given to the freshers. RTL integration is also not given to the freshers most of the times. What is the In front-end domain, what are the only two aspects given to the fresher? What job roles are hired, freshers are hired for? Two job roles. One is functional verification, one is FPGA design. There are two domains in which freshers are hired in the front-end domain. One is what? Functional verification. Second is FPGA system design. That functional verification term covers many things actually. Even though term is one, functional verification, it covers gate level simulations, regression, test-based development, different aspects it covers. The term is functional verification. Same way, FPGA system design is one term, but it has got multiple sub-roles. If we come to backend domain is divided into seven aspects. Synthesis, STA, and fabrication. Synthesis and STA is given to only experienced people. These are critical, some important aspects. Does it mean that other domains are not important? Not like that. Every domain has its own importance, but something a fresher can do, can start off with some guidance. But STA requires a lot of expertise to analyze the reports, to analyze how to fix the violations, everything. It requires some expertise. So they don't give it to freshers. What is the domains which are considered, freshers are considered for? DFT. Actually, DFT we put into front-end category. Physical design, custom layout, physical verification, and post-silicon validation. So whatever you see in the red color here, these are the domains where you have opportunities as a fresher. These are the only domains where you have an opportunity as a fresher. Even if you do a course on STA, as a fresher, your chance of getting into job will be very minimal. Because very few companies come to us for STA requirements, for freshers. They mostly hire from the experience pool. All these domains further have various types of activity which happen over complete project duration. See, functional verification is not something today morning I started, tomorrow evening I'll finish. No. It starts almost with the starting of the project. It's like this. Let's say this is the project duration. Starting date. This is the end date. Let's say it started in January. It is finished in October. This is what? Chip cycle. The chip started in January and it got product is out by when? October. The functional verification will start somewhere here, will almost go to. What does this mean? Sometime in mid of January it will start. Sometime till October first week or second week it will go. So it's not like one day you start and one day you finish. This work, whatever you see, it is further divided into something that experienced people will take, something that fresher will take. Okay, let me not confuse you too much. In summary, all I'm telling is there are only seven domains where as a fresher you can get it. What are the seven domains? Functional verification, FPGA system design, DFT, physical design, custom layout, physical verification, post-silicon validation. As an institute, we are focused in these domains majorly. We don't have course in this one because it requires a lot of investment. I mean, purchasing different instruments to do the post-silicon validation. And the number of people who look for this training is very minimal. Hence, we don't have this course. But we have these domains. We also have training on these domains as well. From a fresher perspective, we are focused in whatever is marked in red. From experienced persons, we are focused on RTL design. We have a training on RTL integration. We have training on synthesis, STA, everything. And fabrication, it's not possible. I mean, it's something you need to have a foundry to do this. So what, as a fresher, what is the domains you should be focused on? These seven domains only. So what is the important question you need to ask in all these domains? Do you want to get into? What is the question you should ask? Do I want to get into front-end domain or do I want to get into back-end domain? That is the critical decision you are going to make. Once you have made that decision, there won't be much difference, because once you have made a decision to get into front-end, there won't be too much difference between functional verification and FPGA. There are at least 50% of the things which are common. Then few things will differ. Same thing if you decide to get into back-end. If you take physical design, custom layout, or these aspects, there are 50 things, a lot of things which are common. Like you need to learn device fundamentals. You need to learn basics of PCL scripting. There will be some skill set which is common. Then there will be a dedicated 4 months course where you can gain the expertise on that specific domain. I believe most of you are here for front-end domain, so I'm not going to talk about back-end aspects. That is where we categorize all the front-end courses. You remember in the first slide, I told you we all these courses, RTL design, functional verification, Verilog, system Verilog, FPGA, RTL design integration, all these courses today is a demo session because all of them have a common skill set required for initial period of the training. Now, across these domains, take front end domain, take back end domain. What is the skill set that is required? Common. You should be strong with digital design fundamentals. How much strong? You should be able to, you should be familiar with, there are around 30 aspects, let's say. Logic gates, truth tables, K-maps, realization of the combination logic, right? Then comes the sequential part. What is flip-flop? What is latch? Different types of flip-flops, different types of latches. Then circuits based on flip-flops and circuit based on latches. Counters, synchronizers, clock dividers. There are almost 20-30 aspects. You should be good with each and every aspect, both as a fresher, both as a experienced engineer, but more importantly as a fresher. Because for experienced person, let's say I'm 14 years experience, I go to interview, nobody is going to ask me draw a circuit for multiplex using NAND gate. Their assumption is what? I know that. So nobody is going to ask me draw a circuit for ring counter. Again, assumption is what? I know that. They won't ask me. Whereas as a fresher, if you go, the more focus will be on the basics only. Because a fresher, they expect you to be good with the fundamentals, not to be good with advanced things. Good with what? Basics only. What is mean by basics? What is the basic for VLS engineer? Digital design and analog design. What is digital design? All this combination logic, sequential logic, everything. What is analog design? Basics of CMOS, basics of FinFET. These are the fundamentals, right? What is CMOS? What is FinFET? How does CMOS based circuits behave? How does FinFET based circuit behave? These aspects you need to learn to some extent. That's where I said CMOS and FinFET basics. Then all the project execution happens using Linux operating system. Even though right now I'm doing training using which operating system? Windows. Windows is good for only for limited things. Documents, opening presentations, watching movies. Very few things it's good. It's not good for all the specific requirements. So for many other requirements where you want to develop a project, you want to run a project, for all those requirements, Linux is the best operating system. So you need to have Linux operating system expertise irrespective of whether you go into front-end domain or into back-end domain. And you need to know one scripting language, either Perl, Python, or TCL. The good thing about these all languages is, if you know Perl very well, you can learn Python in 2 weeks. Again, if you know Python very well, or Perl very well, you can learn TCL in another 2 to 3 weeks. Because there are a lot of things common in all these scripting languages. How you define a variable, how you write subroutines, how do you call them? It's more than scripting, you'll realize that it's about algorithm, understanding how you should be doing it.
Sir, coding is required over the command, sir.
For which one?
TCL.
Coding is required. See, that is what is called as scripting.
Without basics handling.
Without which basics?
In C,
C++. You don't need C, C++. Without that also you can learn. You should have exposure to one text editor, GVim, Notepad++, or any edit. If you see, I was typing a few things here. What is the convenience is, let's say from line number 11 to 20, I want to copy. How will you copy? If it is Windows, Word, Microsoft Word, you'll go here, you'll select, then you'll right click and copy. You know how I'm going to do here? Y9, paste it. I won't even use mouse. I just copied and pasted. Like this, you can do 100 things which makes your coding very convenient for you. With knowledge of text editors. GVim is whatever I'm using, GVim. Here you see it's a Vim, V-I-M. Vim is one of such editors which makes the coding very easy for us. So this skill set is common for everyone, irrespective of whether you go into front-end domain, back-end domain. This is where we do close to 2 months of training to give that fundamentals. Now, based on which domain you get into, let's say you get into front-end domain, along with that, we do Verilog training. Because I can't just teach 2 months this whole topics, right? Most of you might be knowing some of this basic. Verilog becomes your major course, then we cover other aspects. If you go into backend domain, Verilog is not required much. We'll be focusing in depth of CMOS and FinFET. In depth. For a front-end engineer, only basics. For a back-end engineer, in depth of device fundamentals with very minimal exposure to Verilog, almost nothing in Verilog. This is how it works. Now, next question comes, do I need to learn this before joining the course? Like you're attending today, tomorrow you're going to enroll, let's say. Do you need to learn
excuse
all this
me, sir?
Before joining the course? Yeah.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
I have a question regarding custom layout. I'm interested in that, though it is not, your course is not on that presently. But I would like to know if there is any use of Perl in custom layout. Perl coding or Python.
Perl is not required. TCL will be required in custom layout. See,
for
Perl
analog layout,
be,
is it?
What I'm telling is Perl will be required as a generic language. Perl is required wherever you want to do file handling, text processing, all that. I haven't worked in custom layout, so I don't know what kind of such requirements comes to you. I'll just give you one example what Perl can do for us. Just one example in our institute. Just if I go here.
Yeah.
Let's say we send course material to every student. I mean, whatever set training we do, we send, we create the lab notes, we create the labs, like in system like January batch, I have done 20 sessions so far, which was till 13th of March. When we send them, we need to, what we do is, we intentionally keep a header here. Header means what? Someone telling that this belongs to VLSI Guru Training Institute. It's a copyright of VLSI Guru Training Institute, whereas this doesn't have it. What I have to do manually, I have to copy these lines and go and paste it. For if it is one file, it is easy to do. If it is one file, it's easy to do. If it is two files also, it is easy to do. What if there are 1,000 files where I have to go and update every file? Why is it important for me? I'm giving my code. Okay. I need to make sure that whoever is using, they should be aware that this is generated as part of the VLSI Guru training program. So what is that I do? We have a script called as, we develop a script. Which will do that work for us? So how it is going to do? A very simple task. Copy this. I run this. Okay. Now, whatever file I have opened, you see this intersect.v didn't add anything. Now, if I just say load file, it got added. I didn't manually do it. It did. It doesn't matter how many files are there in this folder. Every file will get updated. Every file, wherever there is recursively, if there are 110 folders each below each, wherever it finds that there is a system Verilog file, there is a Verilog file, it updates this header. What is the convenience for me? If there are 1,000 files, for me to manually do this work, it would have taken one full day. Go to each folder, open the file, add it. Go to each folder, open the file, add it. With the script, how much time it took? 1 minute, maximum. So, with the script, what will take, without script, what may take 4 hours, 5 hours, or sometimes one day, with a proper script, it may take only 2 minutes or 10 minutes. So it is basically requirement driven. Whether if you ask someone, ask me, is Perl required in physical design? Answer is yes. If Perl is required in custom layout, answer is yes. But the question is, how much extent is it required?
Yeah, thank you very much.
In front-end domain, it is required a lot. In front-end domain, Perl and Python are required a lot. I mean, as a functional verification engineer, to make my work easier. See, I could have sat and done this work. What would be the problem? I'll lose my pre-sesh time. What I would have used for something more productive. I would have used that same 4-5 hours for something more productive. So what I will do? I will think, okay, see, there is a repetitive work I have to do. Every Verilog system Verilog file I have to code, I need to keep a header in that code. So immediately it will come to my mind that can I use a script for this? Then comes a question, which script should I use? Perl or Python or PCL? Then I realize that either Perl or Python are best. Then I realize that I'm good with Perl. I'm more comfortable with Perl. Then I develop in Perl. The same thing could have been done in Python. It's exactly the same, no difference at all. It is just that my comfort is with which language? Perl, hence I do Perl. But effectively the same outcome comes. What is that I've got? I spent almost 2 hours developing this script. But it is saving me every day whenever I develop my codes, whenever I do, see all the things which we have developed here. Everywhere you see session 4, if you see, if I just open randomly anything, the header is added. And it is added in such a way that this number of lines are variable. Sometimes it will be 10 lines, sometimes it is 12 lines. I intentionally did that. Okay, because someone should not create a script which will go and delete that. They should not do the reverse. So I just tried to make it difficult for them. Okay. So like this, we develop scripts even to make the institute process easier. Now, institute process is nothing to do with VLSI, right? Institute process is different. So there also we can use scripting. There are many places where we can use scripting. So in what is that I want to tell you is, irrespective of which domain you get into, we'll still, you, it is good for you to learn everything. We'll teach all these aspects from the basics.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Now, if you want to get into front-end domain, most of you are here for front-end domain, and people attending online training is also front-end domain. What is the skill set required for you? The most important skill set among all the things is, before we start anything, is that willingness to learn and willingness to work hard. Today, my situation is that, frankly speaking, my situation is that we are not able to send the profiles to the companies. Why? There are opportunities. I might have shown you sometime back, there are opportunities, but we don't have the right candidates to send. Just because someone has undergone training in the institute, just because someone has paid the fee and joined the course, I cannot just forward their resume. There are, you see, just in last, it has improved drastically. The placements have improved drastically. Drastically means what? In 3 months, if 10 to 12 companies come, that's a drastic for us. We are used to a scenario where in physical design, in whole 6 months, not even one or two companies came. Now, all of a sudden, so much improvement happened. The hiring has picked up so much that in design verification, there are almost 10 to 12 companies which hired in the last 3-4 months. Then we came to a scenario where I don't have good candidates to refer. See, I have people. If someone scores 25 out of 100, it is not possible to refer them. After 6 months of training, if someone scores only 25 out of 100 or 15 out of 100, it is not possible to refer because he won't clear anyway. He or she won't clear, and that spoils the repute. So we try to be selective in that case. So why I'm telling all this is, to get a job, most important thing is willingness to spend time, willingness to dedicate yourself to the preparation. That is the primary thing. It doesn't matter whether you know programming or you don't know programming. It doesn't matter at all. It doesn't matter whether you know digital design or you don't know. It doesn't matter whether you know Linux or you don't know Linux. It doesn't matter at all. All you need to know is, I have to get a job. To get a job, I need to develop a passion for learning. Job doesn't come just because you paid fee. Absolutely. Everyone has paid fee. Right? So sometimes we don't intentionally send a profile. Because what happens, they go and they don't perform well. Then it spoils the repute, their repute, our repute, everybody's. And does it mean that we leave them just like that? No, we continue to support. But the point is what? people need to have that energy, I mean that much motivation to take the benefit out of it. So whoever is joining the course should have that motivation that I should spend time, I should that give that extra time and do that. If you ask me, is there anything really different I need to do, where I have to go purchase some books and prepare? Nothing. You just need to follow what trainer is telling. Let's say today I did this demo session. After this demo session, sometime till evening, you should sit for 1 hour, and you should tell to yourself what all things have been discussed. Otherwise, what happens after two months, you won't know what has been discussed in today's session. That basic guideline should be there. What is mean by that? Today this topic is done. Okay, these all topics were done. You prepare a notes, and every day you just follow that. Let's say today trainer tells you that complete assignment one. It's not just given to you. Someone will be there to support you also. When you don't do assignment one, there will be, if you are stuck with something, there will be someone to support you. If you just follow those guidelines, there will be a good chance of getting a job. Nobody can give you 100% guarantee. I will never give you. I'm not giving you 100% guarantee, but there is always a good chance that you'll get a job. Companies are really, I'll just show you one or two conversations with my friends also, how it works. See, there's one friend who want to hire minimum 10 people. This conversation happened Tuesday only. Please send me good ones. So then what happened? I just asked him, what is the requirement? There are few good candidates I'll share. So my concern is what? I'm not able to find that many good profiles. Is it any new skill set that we thought? No. A proper SV UVM AXL protocol expertise that I teach in every session. Now, how does my sessions will be? They will be very in-depth. In my presentations, probably you won't be able to find the presentations on par with my content, not the outlook. The design will be very different, but my way I go in each topic and cover each topic in depth, you won't find that much depth in many places. I have just for very long only, I have almost 462 slides just for very long, where we go and cover all the other aspects like UART. I mean, something we don't cover, CRC, dual port RAM, I2C controller. We would have covered each and everything in a very in-depth aspect. The people fail to catch up with that. We have a solution. We have just introduced something for that also. What we do is, after 2 months of training, we conduct one evaluation test. Once Verilog is done, we conduct evaluation test. If the person doesn't score well, fails to score 50%, he has to repeat Verilog again. Once system Verilog is done, again we do that. He has to repeat system Verilog again. So we are not charging additionally for that. We are just trying. We started questioning where are we going wrong? Why people are not able to catch up? Many people are not able to catch up with Verilog system. In all the sessions, I take effort to make sure that we maintain a notes. See, for all these sessions, I would have prepared a notes. Whatever every session you see, I would have made a notes where I write the notes and I share the notes with the students, so that you only focus in the session. I write the notes and I give you something you miss, you write down. Even after that, students somewhere fail to cope up with the requirements. It's either because they have some personal things. They don't spend the required time. They don't follow the guidelines. What is guideline? Simple. I tell, this week I did this stuff. This week you complete two assignments. Completing is not important. Attempting is important. Many people fail to start that attempt also. If you just attempt and you are not getting, there will be someone to support you. If you don't even attempt, there won't be anyone to support you. Why am I telling all this thing is, that motivation is very important, that I need to get a job, I need to learn. Second thing is, nobody can time a job. Let's say today you are joining, this is what, March. Someone cannot give you guarantee that by September you'll have a job. It might take October, it might take November, it might take next year March also. Because as an institute, we can't control how many opportunities comes. It's just so happened that in last 3 months, almost many requirements. People should be looking at a positive aspect. What is positive aspect? If I prepare well, eventually I'll get a job. So in summary, you need to develop that passion for learning. That learning will automatically get you the job. Now coming back to the skill set, what is skill set required for front end domain? You should be good at reading design specifications, comprehend the design architecture and functionality. I told you, right? In house architecture, you get architecture diagram, you get one document. Similar thing in VLSI also. The person who is going to construct the house, he should understand the document properly, right? Only then he will be able to construct the house properly. Same way, you should be good at reading the specification, understand the architecture and functionality. Second thing is protocols will be there. In VLSI, there are protocols like I2C, SPI, AXI, APP, AHP. There are some protocols. You should be good with those protocols. For that matter, in VLSI industry, there are 50 protocols. If you ask me, do I need to learn 50 protocols? No. Two protocols. Maximum 3-4 protocols. As a fresher, some 3-4 protocols are sufficient. You need to have programming expertise, like hardware description languages and hardware verification languages. I told you, right? Verilog, system Verilog, and UVM. This expertise is required. Then you need to have debug expertise, debugging simulation failures. I mean, if something is failing, you see, I told you, right? You develop RTL code, behavioral code, and you check whether it's working fine or not. Let's say if it fails, something is wrong. How do you figure out that what is wrong? Where to update it? Then tracing design issues using EDA tools, analyzing failing test log. You will mostly realize that the skill set required for front-end engineer is reading the specifications, programming, and debug expertise. In summary, what as a front-end engineer, what is the skill set you need? Reading the documents, understanding it properly. What is mean? Reading each line, each word. What is mean by each line, each word? And comprehending everything. Programming expertise. Protocols. Fourth is what? Debug expertise. For a backend engineer, what is the skill set required? Tool expertise. You should be, backend engineers use a lot of softwares. What do you mean by software? Are you familiar with CAD, computer aided design, where you draw the layouts and other things? It's not just about moving the cursor, right? In computer aided designing, let's say you are using some ARCAD. It's not just about moving the cursor and drawing everything manually. How can you make it convenient? By knowing the options, how to put a box, how to put a circle, where to, what is the dimension, there will be some concepts. If you know that properly, you can use ARCAD tool more efficiently. Same is with backend engineers also. There will be many tools like ARCAD. Similar, I'm not telling you'll use ARCAD there. There will be tools which are similar to ARCAD. You need to know how to use the tool efficiently. So you should have complete VLSI backend flow. Complete VLSI backend flow is implemented using EDA tools. What are the tools that are used? ICC2, PrimeTime, Design Compiler, StarRC, RedHawk, IC Validator. Depending upon the tool vendor, if you go to Cadence, there will be different set of tools. If you go to Mentor Graphics, there will be different set of tools. And other than that, other than tool expertise, you need to have good device fundamentals. Like what is meant by conductor? What is meant by insulator? What is meant by semiconductor? What is the difference? Valence bond and conduction bond. Then what does comes in valence bond and conduction bond? Free electrons and free holes. How do you get free electrons, free holes? Through semiconductor. How do you get free holes and free electrons? Through doping. What is p-doping? What is n-doping? What is meant by free electrons? With the free electrons, what happens? With free electrons, what happens? That level of knowledge you need. It should be fundamental knowledge. It's not that you bi-hearted valence bond and conduction bond are separated. In one case, they are coinciding. In one case, they are close to each other. That's not sufficient. Your knowledge should be one level down, where you know what is meant by free electron, what is meant by free hole. Then what is meant by mobility? How does voltage impact the mobility? How does the temperature impacts the mobility. That knowledge, that level of expertise is required if you are getting into backend domain. Now, does front-end engineer need to worry about what is free electron, what is free hole? No, right? It's not required. It's for a backend engineer. What is N-doping? What is P-doping? What is diode? What is BJT? What is PMOS, NMOS? Not just what is it, how they work technically. What is meant by short channel effect? What is meant by hot electron effect? What is meant by velocity saturation? What is meant by pinch off? How it technically happens? What is the issue with pinch off? What happens? Problem. Second order effects. Circuit based on amortization. Because the physical design engineer works at this level. He works at MOSFET level. So you need to know what happens inside MOSFET, right? Whereas front end engineer doesn't need any of this. See, I learned all this because sometime I taught these topics also. Sometimes I had to teach what is short channel effects. Hence I learned that. Otherwise I didn't knew before this, I didn't know what is short channel effect also, except for my BTech MTech days. After that, I forgot it. And in job also, nobody asked me what is short channel effect. Because as a front end engineer, my skill set is required only in one aspect. You need to know how fabrication happens. You need to know the technology concepts, like what is resistance, what is inductance, what is capacitance. One more thing, we'll do for another 5-10 minutes and take a break. I know it's been close to 1.5 hours. We'll just take a break after this. You should know RC circuit, LCR circuit, what is parasitic means, what is delay types, different aspects. Then you need to know TCL language. What you would have realized by now is a front-end engineer requires a different skill set. A back-end engineer requires mostly a different skill set with very common, small common skill set. What is small common skill set? Digital electronics. What else? Little bit about CMOS and FinFET. Both should have that knowledge. Linux operating system. Then lot of deviations there. Lot of things are which are different. A back-end engineer don't need to know how to read documents, mostly. It doesn't need programming expertise. They don't even need to know protocol. Like my 15 years experience trainer is there, PD trainer. If I ask him AXI protocol, he doesn't know what is AXI. Not that I'm making fun. He doesn't need to know, that's all. So if he doesn't need to know, he won't even bother to learn it. But if I ask him ICC2, he will tell me in depth of each and everything, because that is a skill set he requires. So that is where you, why am I talking about all these things so much? It is the time where you decide what is interesting for me. Whether backend skill set is interesting for me, front end domain skill setting is important for me. Not rather than someone said, go and join verification, go and join physical design. Please do not do that. First, take your own time, figure out what is interesting for you. Then you join. Next, choosing the right course. See, choose either front-end or back-end domain course, interesting course. They will have two months of common training. See, just don't choose physical design, don't choose even layout. Just choose front-end domain or just choose back-end domain. A front-end domain, all courses will have common 2 months courses. Let's say whether you get into FPGA, whether you get into RTL integration, whether you get into verification, functional verification, you will have 2 months of common course. Then you can make a decision after the 2 months whether to go into FPGA direction, whether to go into functional verification, whether to go into RTL integration. Same thing for backend. Layout students, synthesis students, physical design students will have common course, 2 months course, where they undergo device fundamentals, semiconductors, Linux, everything. Then they make a decision which domain they want to get. Job opportunities are there in all the domains. All the VLSI domains are related, right? It's not like two different domains. Everything is interrelated. If there is a work happening in front-end domain, there will be work in back-end domain also, right? That means there will be job opportunities, just that there will be some variations. At one time, one point of the time, physical design will have more jobs. At one point of time, functional verification will have more jobs. So they will normalize over long term. They'll normalize. I mean, today more opportunities, but after 3 months, less opportunities. Other domain will get reversed, right? Don't come with the mindset that I can't do program. If you just come with that mindset, you lose almost 70 to 80% of the opportunities. That is where most of people end up taking physical exam. People come with the mindset that I can't do programming at all because I am from triple E background. I never learned C program. My input would be you try now. You try now. If you are able to cope up, fine. If you are not able to cope up, at least in our institute, there is a flexibility where you can switch to other domain within 1 month. We are not going to charge anything for that. Let's say you choose Verilog today. Today is what? 20th of March. Till 20th of April, you can continue Verilog. If you are able to cope up, good. If you are not able to cope up, you switch to other domain. We are just going to adjust the same fee for other domain. Because, I mean, it is how I can make it student-centric, right? How do we make it convenient? I cannot say that you attended 1 month, we'll deduct and do that. So we try to make it student-centric as long as we don't have anything to get impacted. And I'm not going to force you to get into other domains. Let's say custom layout has only 5 students. I'm not going to tell only 5 students are there. Can you move to physical design? Can you move to functional design? I will not do that. We try to manage because some courses will run with the higher strength. Some courses will run with lower strength of students. I always would look at your interest as one of the criteria. And we try to manage in those aspects. To get more information about these things, you can go to this page, training. vlsaguru.com is common / training - overview. You can also take evaluation test. I think it's not evaluation test, entrance test. Yes. Where you can find different different tests like front end domain or back end domain. You can choose based on which domain. Either you want to get into front end domain, you give the test. There you will test what is the skill set you are finding it more interesting. As you start doing the questions, let's say you go here, if you come across chip is manufactured in 28 nanometers CMOS technology, what is 28 nanometers stand for? What is threshold voltage? If you start finding these questions to be interesting for you and you are aware of this, then backend domain is a right domain for you. Same way, if you go into front end domain test, there will be specific kind of questions which are meant for front end aspect, which will be completely different from backend domain expertise. Based on this also, you can choose whether to go for front-end domain or back-end domain, but majorly you can rely on this thing, skill set, what is interesting for me. But in any case, that motivation is required. That 6 months, 1 year, whenever, till the time I get job, I have to be dedicated to the course. Not like I attended 1 month, for 3 weeks, 2 weeks, I went to native. Again, I came back, again started. That kind of attitude is not going to work, at least to get a job. Course overview. The point again, what is my point of getting job is that proactiveness in session, right? People have to be proactive, not this session specifically. Like you have to be interactive in the session. You need to focus on improving your communication skills, right? Basic grammar like I have, I am, I will, what to use where. Focus on all the aspects. It's not just learning Verilog, it's not just learning system Verilog. Can I explain what I have learned? Institute will of course give emphasis on all the things, but it's not just institute which can do everything, right? You need to have that energy that I need to do it as well. I need to learn English properly. I need to learn the subject properly. I need to learn programming. But if once you have in that passion in you, institute will give you the right path. Course overview, another 2 minutes, we are done. Each course is 6 months duration, irrespective of which course you go for. Plus or minus half a month. Some courses will be 6.5 months, some will be 5.5 months, some will be 6 months. Initial 8 weeks will be basics training, where you learn Verilog and digital electronics in depth. Now, digital electronics, to what depth you learn? At least to a level of gate exam preparation. If you write digital design in gate, you will be able to score properly in that. So everything is covered. All the aspects of digital design will be covered. Almost 80% of these topics will be, these questions will be discussed in the session. So idea is what? If you go to interview, written exam, you should not miss out anything related to digital electronics. Now here comes the difference between a student to student. See, one student, what they will sit, they will do, they will sit and write down answers for each and every question. another student, what they will do, they will just attend the session, trainer will teach, they assume that they understood, they won't do anything. That is the difference where someone gets a job, that is different where someone doesn't get a job. And that motivation is not just for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, it should be there throughout 6 months. Only then you have chance of getting a job, because there is a competition. For every one job, there is no one participant, there are at least 5 people. That means what? Technically, even in training institutes, how it works. If you do basic statistics, I don't want to tell the numbers, at best, an institute can give you 30% placements maximum. Because if there are 300 jobs, at least 1,000 people are getting trained, at least. Because there are not just institutes in Bangalore, right? Hyderabad, Noida, Ahmedabad, different place institutes are there. Every institute runs because there are students, right? If there is no student, the institute will close. That means if you are hearing other institute names, they have students who are enrolling there also. If you add, at best, an institute can give you 30% placements, not more than that. Sometimes it will be higher, sometimes it will be. Be lower depending. As I said, right, in last 3 months we may have had 40% placements or 50% placements. If someone is placements, it is impossible unless I conduct a screening test. I select only the cream of the people, which is not possible to run the economics. The business doesn't work there. If I select only 20 people and run one full year program, the business doesn't work. Okay, why I'm telling is somewhere else you may hear that 80%, 100%, 90%, 70%, which probably won't be true. So the remaining 4 months will be focused on the subject specific domain expertise. If you get into functional education, you will get expertise on system Verilog and UVM. If you go into RTL integration, it's separate expertise. That every course starts once every 8 weeks. That means front end course, I think last batch started on 23rd of Jan. Now we are starting today. That is 8 weeks gap. Back end course starts exactly after 1 week. Because they have some common things to do, like Linux, digital design, common things to do, we start them parallelly. If I do today only, there will be conflict, right? People whether to sit here or whether to sit other room. So we divide it by 1 week. But digital design, ASIC flow, they all happen in common for everyone. Now all front end courses have initial 8 weeks of common training, that is ASIC flow, digital design, and Verilog. A student can opt for main course after initial 8 weeks of training. Course detail schedule. I will discuss all the schedule later. Majorly, there are two types of courses, majorly. Weekend course and full week course. Full week course will be for 6 days in a week.
Sir, I have one query.
Yeah.
So myself, Deepak, I am passed out in 2015.
Yeah.
So I want to enter into VLSI domain.
Yeah. Yeah.
So where I know Verilog and digital design subject is somewhat I know. So can you suggest me which domain I should take?
If you are comfortable with Verilog, then you can get into functional verification.
Okay.
Okay.
Shall I get the placements after the training?
I will discuss all those aspects. Let's do one thing. I think we had a long session. Let's take 10 minutes break. We'll meet after 10 minutes because I don't want to continue. I can, but the point is I need to understand your perspective. Let's meet after 10 minutes and we'll continue.
Okay. Thank you.
This conference will now be recorded.
So we were discussing about the course schedule. I didn't want to hurry. I didn't want to finish quickly. So I wanted to give you a little more detail. The course is divided into full week course because there are almost 5-6 categories of students who join the course. One is working professionals. One is freshers. One is someone from US and Europe, other countries. Then there will be another one, two categories. Majorly, we can place them into 3 categories. See, for working professionals, training will be 2 or 3 days per week. I don't want to just say 2 days because compulsory Saturday and Sunday. One session possibly on Wednesday. Reason is, recently I realized that a 4 hour session of mine or any of other trainers, students are not able to cope up that much. Let's say I'll give you a simple example. During your BTEC electromagnetics or some subject, if I teach 4 hours at a stretch with 10 minutes break in between, will you be able to grasp so much concepts? It's not possible, right? Here also it becomes same thing. If I make you sit for 4 hours and teach Verilog continuously for 4 hours, last 1 hour goes waste. Somehow it feels like you're understanding, but if you go to home and see that you have missed something, you're not able to cope up with that, my 4 hour long session. That's why we wanted to do on experimental basis. We have started last system in Lagbach, it has been successful. I mean, I see more response from the students. Because I was always thinking why people are not able to cope up. Even though when we are giving so much effort, what is mean by effort? I'm doing my own job only, not that I'm doing something extraordinary. I'm doing my own job only. I mean, it could be in terms of sharing the notes, sharing the labs, and just asking them to go through. See, I would have shared everything.
Sir, hello.
All this would have shared with them. Why people are not able to cope up when we are doing all that? So that's where we realized that let's distribute. See, you would have seen that some of them could be weekdays also. One weekday session we do typically. Some of them are working professionals. What we do is we do on Wednesday or Thursday, one of those days in the evenings around 6:30 to 8:30 kind of time. We reduce 1 hour Saturday, reduce 1 hour on Sunday. The 2 hours I plan for one of the weekdays. As a trainer, for me it's difficult actually. It makes it difficult for me because I would, for me, 4 hours at a stretch completes my job for Saturday and Sunday. I would be more relaxed on weekdays. Otherwise, weekdays something will be there, right? I have to do a session on Saturday, Wednesday evening. But when I look back from an interest of the students, I felt that it is good for me to distribute. Instead of 2 days, I should distribute it for 3 days. And another benefit is what? You have one day where you can interact more with the trainer and get your doubts clarified. But we'll mostly go by the students' interests. Sometimes what we do is, for some reason, if someone is not able to attend a session, we share the videos with them. We share the recorded video with them. Let's say Wednesday, someone has office work and they are in a meeting and they cannot join. We share the recorded video. Every session you see here, these all have been recorded, and those videos will be, that video will be shared with the students who request for that. And for that also, we have a proper process. Like we have a process where student can request a missed session video. They just have to tell what is the course, what is the reason why they missed. If they give those details, we share the video with them. I will explain full week program also. So this is about it. And theory sessions on Saturday and Sunday, and one weekday session. This is theory session. When it comes to lab sessions, Saturday, Sunday, 4 hours per day. Because you don't have much time, the people who are working won't have much time during weekdays, hence we plan. But if they are flexible to do on weekends in the evenings, we are open for that. If someone is working, let's say there are 5 people who are working, who want to do training during, who are okay with weekdays evening times also, we can shift this lab session, some of these lab sessions to weekdays also. Mostly it will be driven by the interest of the students. If majority of them says that no, we are okay with weekends only, we'll do. The whole point was that 3 hours plus 4 hours, 7 hours at a stretch is difficult to take so much actually. Hence that idea came. But as I said, once the batch forms, then we discuss with the student accordingly we plan. For freshers, it's 6 days program. Friday is generally off. Why Friday is off? Reason is Saturday and Sunday is when the main trainer will be available, because they are working professionals. So for them, they get time during Saturday and Sunday to do the sessions. Hence, we keep it on Friday off. And other reason is sometimes working people also join. For them, it's easy for them to join on Saturday and Sunday. Hence, we take intentionally, we take Friday as the break for the institute. But institute remains open. You can come sit and practice. You can utilize the resources. I will talk about institute facilities also in a few minutes. How is it divided? It is 3 days of theory. 3 days of labs. Theory session will be common. Both everyone, irrespective of whether you are in working professional category, you are a fresher, or you are online, your classroom, whatever be the case, you are attending from US, theory session is common because my time is somehow limited. Not my means what? Main trainer time is limited. I can't run two parallel batches for the same training. Verilog, I can't do one in the morning, I can't do one in the evening. So we have common time. Same thing, 3 days of labs for US students also. It's just that it can happen at timings flexible to them. At the timings which are flexible to students from US and outside India, basically, rather than just calling US Europe. Okay. So this is about the schedule. Now, when it comes to the timings, mostly we keep it for 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. kind of timings. 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. kind of time. 3.5 hours with a 20 minutes break. It's around 3 hours roughly. There can always be variation of 10 to 15 minutes. And this is how sessions will go. All the theory lab sessions. Except for weekdays, for working professional, if someone is, for them, if you do, it will be in the evening time. 6 p.m. or 6:30 p.m. Like. Is it clear? Someone wanted to know the full week schedule. Is it clear for them? It will be 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. 6 days in a week. There is a change in according to
me. Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, may I know that how the students from e-learning session can they access the lab, or can they join, or is there any kind of program
you
to
can,
attend the lab?
You can join the labs. You can join the live lab sessions also. It is possible
for e-learning students.
Yes, e-learning students also can join because you are also paying the same fee. So it is just that you want to learn at your own convenience. You went for e-learning course. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't limit you from attending lab sessions. You can attend lab sessions. There is no restriction on that. We have in fact created one e-learning lab group also. If you see, I go to my, where is it? We will have one e-learning WhatsApp group also. See, this is front end e-learning March 2021 labs. So this group will be used for conducting labs for you. Even though you're going to e-learning, just going through the videos, you won't learn anything, right? You need to practice. So for that, for practicing, you need someone to support you. That support you will get.
Yes, yes. Any questions? I have joined. I have been in that group.
Yeah. So is it clear to everyone regarding the schedule?
Yeah.
Everything is same, exactly.
Is there any extra we'll add?
Nothing. It's the same thing. It's just that, see, weekends there will be less students. If I ask in this room, there may be hardly 20 to 25% will be working professionals in this training. 75% will be what then? Freshers, right? So who should get more time for labs? Freshers should get, right? Because why? There are more students to if there are two students, I can teach in 1 hour. If there are 10 students, it will take me 1.5 hours to teach them, to address the questions or different aspects. Hence, that minor difference in time will be there. But we are always open to conduct the additional lab sessions. Okay. What will be Saturday and Sunday lab session timing? That is in the afternoon. I mean, lab sessions will be 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. This is for weekend students, not for the full week students. But there is always a chance whenever you miss a session, you get access to the video. We keep recorded videos of each and every session. If I just take. My SV sessions, whatever has happened till session 20, you can see the continuity, session 20, 19, 18, everything is maintained. There is an option to share this video. We share that video. See, intentionally, what you might have seen is we intentionally made it 2 hours kind of sessions. Sometimes 2.5 hours, sometimes 1.5 hour. Around 2 hours plus are something we are doing, because 2 hours I felt is sufficient. I mean, if I do even 3.5 hours, people are not able to. Because earlier I used to do very long sessions. There was a time where my one session was 4 hours also. 4.5 hours also it used to teach. But last 1 hour used to go waste. That I realized lately. So then we corrected that part. Any other questions regarding the schedule? Okay. Deepak, I will address your question. Let me just go through as per the flow.
Hello, sir. My situation is a bit different now. So, accordingly, now the demo class is going now, sir. So, tomorrow will be start very long now.
Yes.
So, when will this ASIC flow design digital electronics concept?
I will cover that. See, the current batch schedule, let's discuss that. Course schedule. Basically, tomorrow course enrollments will start. There is a chance that instead of tomorrow, we may start from Monday, but we'll try best for tomorrow itself. Reason is maybe 50% of the students who are attending the session would have enrolled. 50% haven't enrolled and they want to enroll. Then they start enrolling till tomorrow evening. They miss one session tomorrow. That becomes a problem. They lose track of that. So hence, there's a chance that we may start the sessions from Monday. But by Monday, it will surely start. If there's a possibility, we may start from tomorrow itself. For one full week, Verilog basics training will be there. That is still, today is 28th of March. From 29th March for plus 14 days, plus 10 or 12 days, digital design training. Reason is both of them are interrelated. Digital design and Verilog are interrelated. Kind of to learn, to become good at Verilog coding, you should have proper digital design fundamentals. Right? So they are interrelated again. Okay. Once it is done, 1 day of ASIC training, ASIC flow. Just to get to know what is what. What is meant by synthesis? What is meant by physical design? What is meant by DFT? That's all. Then that will go till when? Maybe 10th of April around. Then from 11th April, plus 6 weeks, Verilog training will continue. There may be few students who have just enrolled only for Verilog who haven't enrolled for digital design. In those cases, for those students, we'll give the Verilog recorded videos. For those students, we'll conduct some dedicated sessions, because there are almost 6-7 students who just enrolled for Verilog. But the students who are attending Verilog Digital will not find any gap. They will not have any gap. We'll make sure that everything is covered. I can't keep a student sit idle for 10 days, right? 10 to 12 days, I can't sit them idle. Ideally speaking, I want them to enroll for digital design as well. But in case you haven't attended, you don't want to attend digital design, we'll conduct some dedicated sessions for them as well during the 10 days. So this is how it goes. This training will complete by Verilog plus digital design plus ASIC flow. Completes by when it will be, today is 20 May, right? Around 17th of May it should come. By 18th of May, system Verilog training will start. Like you are attending Verilog now, you will move to system Verilog training. Same way, whoever has joined 23rd of January Verilog batch, they are going to start system Verilog training in this week. That's how it happens. You roll over to the next domain. This will go for full 3 months. It is done in, I mean, Verilog and system Verilog done in the quite in depth. There is whatever you want to learn, there is so much to learn. I'm not just going to touch upon basic concepts. It's not just going to focus on basic things. It's a quite advanced aspect. There are many times experienced engineers take, then they do give us credit that this course helped us get the better job profiles, right? In this course, I mean, I will talk about projects also. I'm just giving the duration now. This will roughly, when it will complete? May, June, July, August. Around 15th August or sometime, UVM will start. When it will complete? By 30 September, 1st October, it is complete. Means job support. I think it should roughly add up to 6.5 to 7 months, roughly, I believe. Right. So this is how the course schedule will be. Okay, now the question comes when the digital design will be done. Digital design will be done during the weekdays also. It's a full week course because we can't just teach during weekends only. Reason is you take your semester digital design. How many semester was it done for? One full semester, right? Is it possible only if I do weekends, how many months it will stretch to? Instead of 2-3 weeks, it will stretch to 10 weeks. Only if I do weekends. Or at least if not four months, two and a half months, it will easily stretch. People won't have so much time. I mean, now 1-6.5 months itself, many people feel it's very long. If I make it 9 months, it's very difficult. Hence, we do full week. Now the question comes, what if someone is working and they can't attend the sessions? For them, we share the recorded videos of the course. Like as I said, we have the videos for digital design as well. Very detailed videos. These videos will be shared. Like in the last batch, I think it would have went till almost 12 sessions were done for digital design. Of course, different durations. Some are 4 hours, some are 2 hours, like that. It was done in a very in-depth. You can see the session numbers when it was done. The last session was on 17th February. Those videos, students will get access to. Those who miss the sessions. That's about course schedule. Any other questions?
What will be the timing of this digital design? You told that digital design will be happening in the weekdays now. So
yeah,
what will be the timing of those?
Timing will be, you can say 8 a.m. to 10:30 or 11 a.m. Or weekends it will be longer. Weekdays will be around 2-2.5 hours. Reason is even the trainer is working professional.
So you won't be teaching digital design, sir?
I won't be teaching digital design. See, the person who teaches, he is one of the gate top scorers.
Okay, sir. So accordingly, ASIC flow plus Verilog plus digital design will be completed within 8 weeks now, sir?
8 weeks. It will be completed in 8 weeks.
These three topics will be get covered by 8 weeks.
Yes. See, there won't be too much emphasis on ASIC flow. Don't even count. ASIC flow is only for one day. Mostly it's the digital electronics and Verilog which is covered for 8 months, 8 weeks. Is it clear? Any other questions?
Sir, I'm really sorry if I'm wasting time, but I have an issue, sir. Sir,
please tell me.
Sir, my issue is I'm from Tribble background, sir. I don't have much knowledge about digital design, etc.
Digital design will be covered completely from scratch.
Yes, sir. But the problem is I'm now working in IT industry, sir. So I have a schedule.
It doesn't matter. See, the training starts from as much fundamentals as what is binary, what is decimal, what is octal, what is hexadecimal, how do you represent a number at that level, then how do you do the conversion, how do you do the divisions.
Sir, but all will be covered in the weekdays now, sir.
These videos will be shared with you. So the point is what? Yeah.
But
in that case, I have a sincere suggestion to you. I mean, nothing funny. I mean, that. You take 1 month break. You should take, if you are a working professional and you are really serious about getting into VLSA job, you should take 1 month off, first 1 month off. you should get used to the training flow. Basically, you should get yourself comfortable with the training. I know taking 1 month off means losing 1 month salary. But then what is the positive aspect is by taking 1 month off, you can spend full time in the institute. You can learn the fundamentals properly. Then once you go back after 1 month, you know how it works, how the things work in institute. You're already used to the day-to-day things of institute. So you will be more comfortable. That's my suggestion. But doing only during weekends won't work. Reason is what? If I do only everything only during weekends, instead of 6.5 months, it stretches to almost 10 months. Do you understand my concern, Jayant?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I understood, sir. But it isn't possible, no, sir, to leave job for 1 month in the middle. I can't lose my pay.
No, in that case, only alternative is what? You go through the recorded videos. Whatever sessions you miss, we share those videos with you. You go through the video, we can arrange some dedicated doubt clarification sessions.
Yes, but the weekend, it happens during the weekdays, but the course, each and every session is for about 4 hours, 3 hours now per day. After my job is from 9 to 7, from morning 9 to evening 7, I should be covering it in the night and doubt sessions again. That is the concern, sir. I'm really sorry for wasting.
No, I understand that. In that case, what you can do is, just I am customizing the suggestion to you only, not for everyone. Instead of 6.5 months, do the training for 10 months total. Okay. No joke, nothing here. I'm telling you seriously. You first do 2 months of training. Take 1 month break or 1.5 month break. During that 1 month break, you cover up everything. You complete the assignments, complete digital design. Again, start freshly with system verilog after 3.5 months. By then, new batch of system verilog will start, right? Again, you do for 3 months. Take 1 month break, 1 or 2 months break. Then you again start UVM. So overall, system verilog is becoming how much? Instead of 3 months, it is becoming 5 months. Verilog and digital, instead of 2 months, it's becoming around 3 months. UVM is anyway 1.5 months. So that will add to around 9.5 months total. 8.5 months. That way you can make sure that while working also, you will be able to cope up. This is the best possible solution, because with the time, time you spend is the quality of your preparation. There is no other thing, right? Unless you are super smart, just by going through a line, you grasp everything. You have to spend time. To get that quality of preparation, you need to spend time. For a working professional who is spending already 10 hours in office, taking out time will be a challenge. We have this flexibility. I'm not going to limit that your course has started in January. You cannot do beyond July. I'm not going to stop. You will have option to take a course, stop it for some time. You complete your assignments. You continue to take support from the institute. I'm not telling that you are away from institute during that 1 month or 2 months. You will be connected with the institute. You take the support. Then again, you start system verilog. You do it till the time you gain expertise. Then again, freshly start UVM. Does that sounds good for you? That you can do.
But it will be extended, sir. So this digital design process you said will be conducted in weekdays, sir. Which week, sir? Like next week or next week? If I start from this course, I'm going to join.
I told you, right? It will start from 29th of March.
Okay. So from 29th of March, the next week, whole week will be for digital design.
12 days, I said. Not just 1 week, 12 days. It'll almost go for 2 weeks because we are going to take 2 days break, 1 day break.
So the weekdays, every day morning 8:30 to like 12 o'clock, 12
8,
days.
It won't start at 8:30. It'll go till start from 8 itself because the trainer himself is working. He will do till 8 to 10:30. Weekends he will do longer. Weekends he will do 4 hours. Yeah.
So the weekdays will be 12 days.
Yeah, let's do one thing. Can you call after this? I have given you the required information. It may not be addressing everybody's requirement, right? Please call me after the session. I will address your concerns.
I have a query.
Yeah.
This is Suhail.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you please explain which of these course schedule will be taught in week? Like you have written verilog basics training, digital design. Out of this, which will be in the
basic flow will be done during weekdays.
Okay.
Advanced digital design will be done during the full week. Some sessions will happen during weekend, some sessions during the, it's like full 6 days program.
Okay.
Linux operating system will be covered during full week.
Fine.
It will be mostly during weekdays only. Scripting also will be covered during weekdays. Reason is what?
So all these four are in front end itself.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Okay. If you
can attend
them, if you can attend them, it's good. Otherwise, we'll share the recorded videos with you. Reason is,
okay,
we can't keep all these courses only weekends.
I have understood. Yeah. No problem. The timing will be morning session. Morning session.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
The next question is what duration mentioned here? Some private questions.
So Srinivas, I have a question. Quick question, like, so. Hello.
Yeah.
I'm looking only for DFT classes. So I have some experience in VLSI industry. I'm looking mainly for experience.
I understand. But see, the point is, even though you are looking for DFT,
I have to go through all this. Yes. I understand.
Tomorrow,
the DFT classes will be done.
What is large flop? What is capture flop? You need to have some basics. You need to have some basics of Verilog simulation. What is Verilog? How do you set up a test bench? How do you run a simulation? That much knowledge. You should be good with digital design, because tomorrow we are talking about scan flop. He's talking about combination logic. He's talking about sequential logic. You don't understand much of what is combinational sequential. Then it will be difficult for the trainer to teach you. So you will undergo this basics training. It won't be very long. Then the DFT core training will start. See, the DFT core training will only be on weekends.
Okay. That was my question.
Like core subjects are
the core will be on the weekends, right?
Only weekend. There is no weekdays.
Okay. Then that's
Verilog, system Verilog, and UVM is only on weekends. I told you that there is a possibility that we might do one session over weekdays in the evenings, because not for my convenience, it is to give the better quality of training, so that by distributing it, instead of two long sessions, distributing it to three shorter sessions, you have better understanding, ability to understand the things properly. It as a process, it is difficult for institute, because someone has to be available at 6:30 and someone has to schedule a session. That whole process will increase the complexity for us. But again, as I said, it is to make the things to get that more quality from the students. I mean, the quality of learning should improve. That's the whole point. Now, coming to this, what duration you mentioned there, is projects included in the course? Yes, projects are included. If I go to the front end training, whatever projects you see here, every project will be done in the course from the scratch. Design parallel in serial out, serial in parallel out, I2C controller, interrupt controller, SPA controller, synchronous asynchronous FIFO, switch verification, AHP, UVC development, all these projects will be done from scratch. There are some other mini projects also, like dynamic pattern detector, watchdog timer, dual port RAM. Now you ask me, is it possible to do so many things in limited time? That is the very reason course is stretching to 6.5 months. If I do it only for 5 months, at least 50% of the projects would not be possible. We are stretching it to 6.5 months so that we can do, and I have shown you a presentation, right? My presentation where we do these topics, like SPI controller. How we start? We start with understanding what is SPI. A long presentation. What is SPI? Where SPI is required? Okay. What is SPI protocol? Why SPI protocol is required? How does the timing diagram look like? What are the signals? What are the observations you make from the timing diagram? And how does the SPI master behave? Then how does the basic architecture looks like? Controller overview. Then how the architecture looks like, coding of the SPI controller, then how do you come up with the state machines, then how do you do the register programming? All those aspects will be covered. It's not just that I open the code and show you that this is the SPI code and I give. Most of the things will be developed from the scratch. The only thing is, even this presentation is shared with the student. I mean, we have an e-learning page where you get access to this portal. you'll be given login to this. Based on which course you enrolled for, you get corresponding login details. Let's say if you go to Verilog, so you will have access to the presentation. This is the first presentation what I was talking about. So you will be able to go through most of the things I've shown you there. Other than that, you'll get access to session notes. Whatever I'm typing, session notes are uploaded here. And all the assignments, see, there are almost how many assignments? 23 assignments. Each assignment won't be like one line or anything like that. It'll be a detailed assignment, step by step, where we tell what to do. How hardware differs from software, how Verilog implements, how Verilog language differs from C language. Some basic theoretical questions, some practical questions. In all, what is required from a student is that willingness to complete. Some IQ is required. Minimum IQ, if I tell, you should be focused in the session and you should grasp what I'm able to, what I'm talking. Other skill set that is required is that willingness to spend time and complete the things.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, all these 9 projects will be covered in e-learning also?
Yes, yes. They'll be covered in e-learning also.
And sorry, but sir, this the PPT of Verilog which you were showing earlier, it is a new one. Can you update that in the e-learning of Verilog?
No, we don't intentionally. We don't keep each and every slide. There will be some 5 to 10% variation will always be there.
Okay, sir.
Okay. 5 to 10% Earlier, I was not even giving PPT because people do a lot of things. Now we thought, okay, let them do. But remaining people should benefit. That's the reason. It at least close to 95%, 90 to 95%. What is there? And other thing is, I keep updating. See, this was not 462 slides. Probably 2 months back, it was only 420 slides, 430 slides. I would update as and when I find something new. I keep updating it. My system Verilog PPT is almost 500 pages. Almost 500 or even more than that. 529 pages, which is only covered for 7 weeks duration, 7 to 8 weeks duration. I spend so much time just going through the system Verilog. Now, as I said, what is the only thing required from students? You should be spending enough time to cope up with my speed. If you have find that lagging, right? So you, that becomes continuous lag. So coming back to the presentation, we discussed all that. It includes multiple hands-on projects. The only thing is, if you can do these projects,
sir.
Yeah.
Sir, for e-learning student, is it only PPTs or the videos also available for them?
E-learning students will get access to the videos also. Down, see, if you see here, there will be videos with duration and everything. You will get access.
Okay.
The regular students will not get video access. They'll get the material access. Like Verilog is there. Similarly, one will be there for digital design. Similarly, one will be for system Verilog UVM. That whole access, material access.
For e-learning, both of the material also, yes, and the videos also, both of them.
Yes.
Okay.
For us, it's convenient because it's like one centralized place where everything is put up. Let's say tomorrow I want to add interview questions. I'll add one more unit. I'll keep interview questions. So I don't have to send 5 mails, one presentation, one assignment, one interview question. I just keep uploading here. That way you get access to the latest material. This access will be, this at least material access will be there for at least 1 year. At least. Plan is for minimum 2 years, but right now I want to commit for 1 year at least. The next is, the functional verification training is 28 weeks. 8 weeks is Verilog, ASIC flow and advanced digital design. 14 weeks is system Verilog for functional verification, Linux operating system, one of the scripting. Last 6 weeks of training is for UVM for functional verification, SOC concepts and division management. Most important things for you would be Verilog, digital design, system Verilog, UVM. These 4 topics are more important. Python and Perl is like an additional skill set. By learning that, you get more efficient. But it is not a very compulsory skill set for job. Revision management is also not compulsory. But when you get into job, this skill set is required. The next question is, these projects for fresher, is it beneficial for experience in new services?
The projects are,
the projects are meant for both freshers and experienced engineers. I'll tell you why is it meant for experienced engineers. Generally, once you join a company, you will understand that the project runs for 10 months duration or 8 months duration, 6 months duration. You don't get to work on the complete project. You won't do all the steps in the project, like setting up test bench, developing test cases, different aspects will be there. I don't want to go into that because you don't understand what is test bench, what is test case. What expertise you couldn't get in the companies, you'll get that expertise here. Because here, you're going to start from reading a specification. You start from reading the specification. You go through the document in thoroughly, where trainer will teach you everything step by step. You do the complete flow. If I go here, one of the system verilog we did, let's say DMA controller project. That was done in December 2020, where we took the specification, we developed the test plan, we understand the requirements, we come up with the test plan, we list down the test cases, we understand the intent of each test case, we develop this plan, then we come up with the test bench architecture, we develop whole verification environment from scratch. This kind of exposure, very rarely you get in the companies, because in company, a one engineer doesn't get to work on the complete flow. That is how companies work, actually. That is how companies work. What is the example in cases? Our institute admin is there. Will he be able to do everything in the institute? No, right? Why? Because I want to make best utilization of him. So I will only limit some percentage of the activities. I tell him, these 10 activities you do efficiently. Don't try to do other things. Same thing happens in the job also. One engineer is not given the complete row, complete flow. He will be given only limited activities. He has to do well in that activity. By coming to institute, you can get exposure to the complete flow, which you couldn't get in the job. I hope that addresses your questions to Trupti. If I miss any class, how many days the missed video is available for me? See, how the missed video will be accessible for at least 2 weeks, whatever you miss. It should not become a point that every session you miss and every session you ask for. Then we simply say, go for e-learning course. If you keep asking every session, let's say I missed yesterday, I missed again today, I missed tomorrow. Then we say, instead of this, it is better for you to enroll for e-learning course where you get access to all the recorded videos. Those videos will be shared. There won't be any restriction on it. 2 or 3 weeks will give you. I mean, the timing that is comfortable for you to go through those videos. Okay, next. In front end VLSI, risk 5 is also there. Can you explain how are opportunities in risk 5? Is it part of front end domain or is it? So risk 5 is part of front end domain, but currently it doesn't have many opportunities because industry hasn't moved to risk 5 so far. Industry is based on what architecture now? 8086 architecture, or you can say the standard processor used is what? ARM process. It's based on ARM processor, right? So why people are talking about RISC-V? Because it's a no licensing cost is there. They'll give you the basic architecture and the whole thing. You can develop your own code and you can use it. For in case of ARM, companies have to pay some money. Like Qualcomm, for every chip that is manufactured, they need to pay royalty to ARM company for every chip. Doesn't matter whether they make 1,000 chips or 1 crore chips. In RISC-V, that won't be there. So companies might move, but now it hasn't happened. Probably we'll say RISC-V is only 5% and ARM is how much? 95%. So where are the more jobs now? Right. What should you be learning now as of today? Right. After 5 years, I can't tell you. But as of today, you go by what is today. So hence, RISC-V is not to be focused today. But before you reach RISC-V, there are many other things for you to learn. Then in the end comes the RISC-V. I hope it is clear to you, Suhail. Any other questions you have?
Sir, do we have a DFT class today at 3:30 p.m.?
I will tell you. I will just confirm with the trainer and I'll inform you. If not today, tomorrow we'll have it. I will inform you what I'll do. Please do one thing. Those who are is attending DFT, please leave your email IDs in the chat window. Wherever people are questioning, right, there you mention DFT. Like I will tell you one example. DFT Srinivas, my mail ID is srinivasreddy.k@gmail.com. Something like that, let's say. Please leave your email ID like this. So I know that you are enrolled for, you are interested in DFT demo session. Please do that so that you don't miss that link. Those who are in classroom, they have given that sheet, right? Just mark it as DFT. Who are all here for DFT? You, right? Yeah. Anyone attending online interested in DFT? Yeah, others also please leave in the same format so that I know that you have come for DFT. Okay. Now the next questions. Okay. Is there any specific requirement for labs? For lab session, is there any specific requirement for laptop or PC specs? i3, i5 will be good. 4GB RAM, 4GB plus anything will be best. If you can have i5 with 8GB RAM, it will be perfect. Even i3, 4GB RAM is what you get standard at lower cost, right? That will also do. But any better configuration will make it easy for you. Why is it so? Is most of the jobs are not run in your laptop, except for basic tools. Most of the tools are run in server. You just need a laptop because you want to connect your laptop to the server. Any other questions? Similarly, RTL integration training. Is there anyone for RTL integration training here? Students attending online, same thing, like you write RTL integration, name and email. If someone is attending RTL integration, and same thing for FPGA. If someone is attending FPGA training specifically, please write FPGA, name and email. So my assumption is what? Everyone else is for functional verification. So those who have left the details here, we will send the email to you. As soon as the session is done, I will update you. I'll check with the trainer what time is comfortable for him and we'll inform you. Would e-learning students, no, because uploading each and every video on the current batch is very difficult for us. It's a previous batch videos. My one or two batches old videos will be there. Those videos only will provide. Because the admins are limited, he will have limited bandwidth. I mean, to maintain that whole thing in our e-learning page requires some dedicated bandwidth. We have earlier recorded e-learning videos with the intention of e-learning only. They are done in a very depth, very detailed manner. So you will get the standard course material. When the lab sessions will be conducted for e-learning? It will be either along with the regular sessions, along with regular batch, based on your availability, regular batch or weekends. If it doesn't work, some dedicated timing will be taken only for e-learning students. Let's say there are 4 e-learning students now. For them, we conduct 1 dedicated lab sessions, which is different from other live training students. I hope Vinod, it's clear to you. So to answer your question in short, we will make a group of e-learning students. For them, we dedicated
okay. Okay.
One second, I'll be just back in a minute. So I'm working in IT for 3 to 4 years. Is there any way to enter verification profile? So I will not go roundabout. I'll just give a very straightforward answer. If you are working in Wipro, HCL, or Infosys, or any company which has got some VLSA division in that, any company for that matter, even Tech Mahindra, anywhere, right? Then you can easily get into VLSA domain, because you need to show that this, whatever I'm talking now, next 2 minutes, won't be ethically correct. But this is what people do. What they do is, if you are working in Wipro, in a networking domain, you want to move to verification. What do you do? In Wipro, you show, in that company, you show that you have worked in what? VLSA team. And you gain that expertise in the institute. And you get the projects in the institute. That projects you show for the two and a half years experience. With that experience, you try. I told you that my suggestion may not be correct, but that's what people do. Now, is it possible for us to gain that 2 months or 2 years of expertise in 6 to 7 months? It is possible, because you know, right? Someone who is working at 3 years, it's not like every minute and every minute, hour he's learning something. There is a lot of repetitive things you do across 3 years job. So whatever expertise someone gains in 3 years can be gained in 6 to 7 months also with a concentrated, focused effort. So if my answer to you, Prasanna, is simple. If your company has any work related to embedded systems or VLSA domain, then it is possible for you to move to VLSA domain. Otherwise, it will have its own challenges, because people will ask you, how did you work in? Then it's difficult. You have to, if you are working in web development profile, it will be difficult for you, because how do you justify that gap? The only other option is, if you are from a core software company, what I mean by core software company, no VLSA, no embedded division, then you try with the same experience. There will be few companies who will be willing to hire you because of your gap. With that gap, they show that as an internal experience, and then they project you to the client. How they do that is different. Only challenge will be, you will have to start with a lower salary. 15,000, 20,000 lower salary, then eventually your salary goes up. But if you are from Wipro, HCL, Infosys kind of thing, you won't have any salary reduction. The salary naturally will grow, because they will believe that you did work in VLSA division, they will give you the rise. But if you are working from a core software company and want to move to verification domain, you have to initially compromise on the salary part. Then you can eventually, as you gain expertise, you can move to the better job profiles with better salary and better work. Prasanna, is it clear? Prasanna. Technically fresher, but there are with some restrictions. Reason is, if you are 3-4 years experienced, you must be 2017 pass out. If you are 2017 pass out, whoever comes, whichever companies comes, they won't consider 2017 pass out as a fresher. There will be few select companies who hire a candidate because they have a gap in the education. There will be few companies in the market who hire people with gap only, because they want to project you as an experienced person. That chance you have to take. But in all, only one thing, one line I'll tell you. If you have the knowledge, you are the king. It doesn't matter. You may say, will institute get me a job? Will institute not get me a job? All those questions won't be there at all. If you are knowledge, properly knowledge, and you have the complete domain expertise, right? You will be king. What I mean by king, after 10 years, you will become the manager also. Director also you can be. Your knowledge is going to make that all the difference. Maybe I'm telling like a very motivational speech, but that is a fact. You will see people at 25 years experience working at a lower salary. Someone with 10 years experience also working much higher salary. What is that difference made? It's not their looks, right? It's their domain expertise. So in summary, to answer your question, Prasanna, it is possible for you to gain it. One second. it is possible for anyone to get into VLSI domain, for that matter any domain. You need that focused, dedicated effort. It is just that there may be 1 or 2 years of time where you may have to compromise on the salary part. Sometimes people may start with, even freshers may start with 15,000 per month. Sometimes freshers may start at 40,000 per month or 50,000 per month, sometimes even higher. That difference will be only there for 3 years, 2 to 3 years. After that, it gets normalized.
Srinivas, Prasanna here.
1 second. Yeah, someone had a question.
Hello.
Next question is.
Hello.
Yeah, please tell me.
Yeah, present here, Srinivas. As I was asking, like I've been working in IT only, so I'm not bothered about salary things, but basically I'm from electronics background when I passed out, but I switched to IT. So I started working, and it's been almost 3-4 years, pretty good, you know, this CTC and all, but when I you know, I'm interested in VLSI now again, so if I try to enter that, so is there, like, you know, I'm worried, only one thing is, like, the companies will put some barricade or something, like you are from IT and you have experience in IT, you know, there's something else. So how they'll consider me, like, you know, that's what bothering me, not the salary part. Yeah, the only thing is how they accept me.
It's not, basically what is going to happen is you will not get opportunity in almost 60-70% of the companies. You will not get, I mean to say, because they will either want fresher, or they will want experienced person with the relevant experience. Relevant means worked in VLSI. But in your case, you have experience with a non-relevant experience. So you will be open to around 30-40% of companies who will hire you based on your expertise. If you are good with the subject, they will hire you because they know that they can get the work done through you. So answer is still, it will be still possible for you to get into VLSI domain. But with some challenges. So as I said, challenge could be, what first thing could be, working at a lower salary, to starting off a career with a lower salary. If you are okay to compromise on that, it is possible for you to get into the industry.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, next. Would it be possible for you to e-learning student? Yes, it is possible. You can attend the live physical practical sessions on Saturday and Sunday. It's possible. The next thing, any other questions? So I just about brief about RTL integration. I don't see anyone for RTL integration here. Okay, Jay Parekh is there. Okay, basically it's divided into 8 weeks. Initial 8 weeks will be on same thing, Verilog, ASIC Flow, digital design. Later 8 weeks will be on RTL integrations, Lint, CDC and UPF. Later 8 weeks will be on synthesis, LEC and STA. FPGA training will be 24 weeks, 8 weeks will be the common thing, 16 weeks will be complete FPGA flow with hands-on board-based projects. And you can, in this link, you can find the FPGA course structure. The course material will be shared. Most of the material will be shared as a e-learning material, but whatever you can download, even the downloadable links are here. Important links, if you go. There itself, if you click, you can get the, you can download the course material, everything here itself. In summary, what we tried to do is we tried to create this platform which has everything in it. We don't want student to come back and say, I didn't get course material, I didn't get assignments, I didn't get labs, I didn't get notes. One page where everything is present. So what do you get? Project code, practice examples, you get documents, you get course assignments, you get the labs, you get interview preparation questions, you get session notes, all those aspects you get. What are the next thing is institute facilities. Basically, when you come to the institute physically, you get access to all the recorded videos at the institute premises. There is one video room where you can watch all the course videos. Whatever I have shown you here, right? Whatever videos are there in our YouTube private videos, most of them are uploaded to our systems. We thought when anyway we have the videos, why not students benefit out of it? So we gave a flexibility where we have arranged some 10 systems that can be extended to another 17 systems totally, which will be accessible and you can come and watch anytime those videos. There is no additional charge for that. Access to miss session videos to watch at the home. Let's say you miss any session, we share the recorded videos. The only question comes when someone keeps requesting too many videos, then we say that we can't, we ask for a reason. In the extreme case, we ask them to move to e-learning course completely. You get access to Synopsis and Mentor Graphics tools for 12 months at the institute premises. You can come here and practice the tools anytime. We are not going to restrict you have completed the course, you can't come. That won't be there. There might be a student who has completed training in 2019 and he's still coming here. So I don't differentiate, we don't put such restrictions. For students attending online, it will be access will be given for the course duration. Whatever is the course duration, it can be 6 months or whatever be the duration. During that time, they'll have access to the tools. Option to repeat the course in classroom. Let's say someone has attended the course, they want to again repeat in June 2021 or August 2021. They can repeat the course till next 1 year without any additional fee. Some of them don't apply for online student because online repetition is not a policy. There is a because there is a chance for people to misutilize that. If someone is attending physically, I know that he is the person who is repeating. Someone attending online, there is no guarantee that he is the one who is attending. There is always a chance for misutilization. There is a chance where 3-4 people are sitting and watching the same session at time. So we may ask you to switch on your webcams because we have to protect our business interest also in this whole process. So that will be there. These are the little some of the facilities. Institute will be open. Even if you can manage to come by 7, 8 a.m., institute will be open. Till 9 p.m. also, institute will be open. The placements. You get job opportunities across various locations in India. Mostly you see that VLSI companies are 70% of companies are there in Bangalore, more than 70%. Some of them are in Noida, Hyderabad, and some are in Pune, very few in Pune. So wherever opportunities are there, you will be eligible for all those opportunities. Every student is offered at least 6 opportunities. It is subject to the situation at that point of time. See, if someone is attending training, someone is continue to interact with the institute. What is meant by interact means? Someone is just part of the WhatsApp person. Someone is just part of DV job group. The DV job support is there. Someone from December, long back, this is December 2019 batch. This name is December 9 means December 2019, April 2020, February 2020. Someone is from December 2017. So different people can be there. All of them are added into the same job support group. As soon as they complete training, they get added to the group. Right now, the ongoing batch also we have added so that we can conduct the tests, everything easily. This is where you get the job support group. If you just go back in the same thing, you will see more hiring happening in last 3-4 months. There is a more hiring happening in one of the, this is one of the company. At least 10 to 12 companies would have started, would have conducted the hiring. Same thing 1 year back, it wasn't like this. But instead of 12 companies, only 2-3 companies would have come. So what is the difference? The patience is the difference. Student need to have that patience that if not today, eventually after 6 months, 1 year, I will find a job. And every month you should see that some improvement should be happening with your skill set. It's not like forgetting the subject, you should be improving the subject. That's the difference. Many times what happens, people complete 6 months training, their learning curve goes down drastically. just to draw, just to show you that physically, if you see, you'll learn it. If it is 6 months, if it starts like this, like this, like this, if you don't keep in touch with the subject, you come back here. What I'm telling is, once the training is done, you do something like this. Because you don't have to attend any more training sessions, you try to improve. This is what is the difference between a person who gets job, person who don't get job. That is where you will still need some support from the institute. To continue your learning, you will still need some support from the, that is where institute will support you.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, the same support will be given to the e-learning students?
Exactly same support. So number of opportunities also depend on percentage during the evaluation test. See, sometimes what companies will say is, just give me only top 10 profiles. Like you saw, right? One of the person asked only what? Top 10 profiles. Even if I give 50, he won't have time to shortlist them. If I don't have any good profile also, I won't even share many times. Okay, not that I don't want to give opportunity, but I get a realistic assessment of how much a student is scoring. Based on that, we give the marks. I mean, based on that, we consider them for opportunities. I think that's all I want. I mean, I would actually end the demo session here. I would want to talk about what is functional education, but what I realize is, to just start off with understanding SOC subsystem module, for many of you who are freshers here, you may not understand too much of it. The whole point is, I wanted to just spend some time, go through what is functional verification is, why functional verification is important, different types of verification, what are the different steps in functional verification, then how the career in functional verification will be, all those aspects. Only one thing I want to tell is, for the people who want to get into functional verification is a evergreen domain. What is evergreen domain is, at every stage, even if it is a recession, there will be one or two opportunities in the market. I don't know why is it, I mean, one reason is a lot of functional verification engineers are required in the market. In a team, if there is a team of 100 people, at least 40% of people are from functional verification domain. So because of that, there will be opportunities. As I said, there are functional verification is an important aspect of VLSI. Industry gives a lot of emphasis on functional verification. 40% of team in general constitutes of verification engineers. Hence, there will be more opportunities. I think let's not get into it. I mean, I'll cover when we start with the main course, because a lot of these terms, modularity, reusability, all that, you may not be able to pick up in today's session. I will rather stop here. Any questions you have? If you
Hello,
still
sir?
Want to go through that, 1 minute. If you still want to go through that, there is this link. Demo video. It's the same video around half of the session. Let's say, if you go after half of the session, you'll see the same expression, whatever I covered in the later part, right? You'll see the same thing. Now, today I'm skipping it intentionally, because what I realized is, with all these demo sessions, that last 1 hour thing, what I'm teaching functional verification, it's not helping the freshers any much. Rather, it's good for me to give the overview of the course, what all aspects you should focus on, because functional verification, system verilog, UVM, they get covered anyway during the course. Hence, I'm intentionally skipping that part. Yeah, someone had a question.
At what time DFT core demo starting, sir?
DFT. Core, okay. Please give me 5 minutes. I'll just confirm with the trainer and let you. It can be either today okay. or tomorrow. I'll inform you. Anyway, I have your email IDs. I'll confirm you. But let me check with the trainer and confirm you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? In the meantime, please fill this form. We will have it tomorrow evening. Like, he's our trainer, so we'll have it tomorrow evening. That I will tell you exactly what time. 4 p.m. is fine with everyone. Those who want to attend DFT, can they attend demo at 4 p.m. tomorrow?
Yeah, okay, sir.
Okay, so Sunday, 4 p.m. Everyone, please fill this form. This form is just those anyway in classroom have filled the names, right? So we just want to know who all have attended the demo. Just for that information, we have sent this form. Please fill this form, front end demo registration. Even if you are attending DFT, you please fill that. I'll just do one thing.
Do we have a DFT demo later today?
Not today, not today. I told you, right? It will be on Sunday at tomorrow at 4.
Okay, okay.
I mean, which domain did you attend? Like, do you want to attend DFT or do you want to attend a front end domain? Those things, please fill. Any other questions?
Sir, is there going to be a class tomorrow? 9 to 1?
9 to 1? No, let's start it from Monday. What I'll be doing is, I'll be giving you some basic videos to go through, some basic course material and the video. I want you to ramp up on that video. Quickly go through. From Monday onwards, we'll be starting with the sessions. For the students who are attending only weekends, the sessions will start from next Saturday.
So Monday, what will be happening with weekday batch, sir?
Weekdays, what will happen is, we'll start with the basics of Verilog. Like, we take an example of AND gate. How to implement AND gate using Verilog. Then how do you write a test bench for AND gate?
Sir, but you said that the weekdays happen from 29th, no sir?
Please come again.
You said that the weekdays will start from, like, the weekday classes will be starting from 29th now in the text editor.
That is, I said digital design.
So Verilog basics will be starting from Monday only for weekdays.
Monday onwards only, yeah.
Okay, sir. Sir, my case is a bit different, sir. I want to explain.
See, what I'm telling you, Jayant, for just for one student purpose, we cannot disturb the whole course schedule.
Yes, that's what I'm trying to help you understand.
If you have a specific thing, I can address your concern separately. My point is what? I'm trying to tell that it is not possible for us to do everything during weekends. It's not possible for us. So we will doing during weekdays. Whatever sessions has to be done during weekdays, it will happen. If you are not able to attend, we'll share the videos with you. If not, we'll provide some backup sessions for you to cover up whatever doubts you have.
That is what, sir. I just wanted to tell that I want to call you after this session. How should I?
You can call me after the session. We can discuss surely.
Sir, how should I contact you? Like number.
I will give my number. Call me on that number.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Sorry to.
I have given my number. Please call me on that.
Thank you, sir.
Someone with MBA experience also becomes the same scenario what I was telling. They will not be eligible for most of the many companies. But companies might still treat MBA recently passed out means they may still treat you as recent pass out only. You may get fresher opportunities. Naveen, you may get fresher opportunities in that case. Any other? Sir, DFT will be online tomorrow at least. No need to come here tomorrow. Any other questions? See, how DFT works is, I'll tell you. How the classroom training works is, if you see here, there are almost 10, 11 students who are in the classroom. 10 of them want to attend front-end training or some different course. So it becomes very easy for us to plan. If there is only one student and remaining 9 students want to attend online, the trainer stays in Marthali, he wouldn't want to take that much effort to come here for one student. I'm being very frank with you. Whereas if there are 7, 8 students, like for me, I have no option because I stay here. I have no problem. I stay in the first floor. I can come anytime and do the classroom. For me, there is no difference between classroom or online training. When it comes to DFT kind of course, his point is simple. Trainer is willing to do from the classroom also. At least some minimum students should be there in the classroom so that whatever effort I'm putting to come down to the institute, it should be justified. That's his point. Even today, he says that I can come, but show me some students in the classroom. It's not videos, you have to attend live again. Yes, next batch. Yeah, because by when it course completes, we conduct a test, a 2-3 hours test that gives us a basic idea whether you are able to learn or not learn. You don't need to score 100 out of 100. Just 50 out of 100 is sufficient. That gives me confidence that at least you have basic learning of Verilog so that you can move to the next level of the system. From a student perspective, what should be their motivation? Not about completing course in 6 months. It's about gaining that expertise. I should have even if instead of 2 months, let me spend 4 months on Verilog. But I should have so much expertise that just with my Verilog experience itself, company should give me job. It is possible, in fact. To be frank with you, just with a very good Verilog expertise and little bit of system Verilog, you can get jobs. As I said before, companies don't hire because you know too many things as a fresher. They hire you because you are good with few things you know and you know them very depth. That tells you that what is your capability of learning a subject. If you can learn Verilog to a depth, you can learn system Verilog also to a depth, right? They want to see the passion of your learning. That's all. Someone who has 2 years of experience but didn't get exposure to projects, they consider as a fresher. The 2 years experience, it depends upon in which domain you have the experience. If it is in VLSI, whatever projects you do can be shown as a relevant projects. I'll come in a minute. Yeah, I hope it answers your question. So if the work is relevant to VLSI, whatever projects you do during the course work, institute training, you can show them as relevant projects and you can try as an experience. Any other questions? Backend course is starting from 27th of March. 9 a.m. demo session. The same way it will be there. That again will start from 29th March. Main course will start. We'll take Sunday break for enrollments to complete. Then the main course will start. That will start with digital design and ASIC flow, which is common for both front end and back end students. Only the front end students, what they are doing during this week is just getting comfortable with the tool, getting comfortable with the basics of Verilog programming like AND gate, OR gate, multiplexer, some kind of basic things. Then you go into digital design. Any other questions?
Sorry.
You want me to? Yeah. Okay. You want me to give a brief about physical design? Okay. So physical design course. It would cover all the aspects more specifically from physical design perspective. A 2 months basic course which is focused on VLSI flow, semiconductor fundamentals, ASIC, advanced digital, Linux, and TD flow keywords, and TCL scripting. The rest of the flow will be for 4 months, starting from synthesis, constraints, UPF, NDM, more physical design specific topics. This will be covered during the next demo session. You'll get a complete overview. Okay. what is the right time to start training after completion of the college or start right from the final semester. What you should do is, it depends upon how much time do you have. If you are already caught up with your BTech project and you are not able to spend time, then don't go for the course. But if you have time, it is better to do Verilog training in final semester. Just complete Verilog. So your 2 months is utilized. You spread it over 3-4 months. You don't do system Verilog. Once you pass out of the college, you start with system Verilog. System Verilog and UVM. So you don't have to spend that 6-7 months, right? Now you can finish up the whole thing in 4.5 months. You will be quickly able to apply for the jobs. Any other questions? Can e-learning student come to Institute Access Tool? Yes, you can come to Institute and access a tool. 1 year is only notional thing. See, I can't tell the term lifelong, lifetime, right? Because after 10 years, we don't know what can be the scenario, all that. So we don't want to give that lifetime commitment. Even if you have come after 2 years, I'm not going to tell why did you come. We are not going to stop in the entrance. People do come. We don't have any restriction. Just that 1 year is like some number should be there, right? That's the reason we keep 1 year. Any other questions? Okay, so we'll end the session here.